to cover tonight. So, last week, did I talk at all about the chapter of the shadow of the past? Or did I only do the forward? Only did the forward. Okay, that's what I thought. So, just making sure. Okay, open your books briefly to A Long Expected Party. Pages 32 and 33. How many of you have read The Hobbit? Anybody? A few of you. Okay. How does The Hobbit begin? Anybody know? Title of the first chapter? It's an unexpected party. This is a long expected party. Okay. Frodo and Bilbo are getting ready to celebrate their collective 144th birthday. Bilbo's turning 111. Frodo's turning 33. He's coming into his inheritance, all that kind of stuff. So they invite 144 people so that it's easier for Bilbo to give out gifts. Hobbit fashion is when it's your birthday, everybody gives you gifts. This is what we do at my house. When it's my birthday, everybody gives me gifts. When it's their birthdays, everybody still gives me gifts. So as part of that, Bilbo does that to make it easier to give away one particular thing, the ring. So he comes to the big climax of his speech at the party tree, slips the ring on because he wants to surprise the hobbits. Gandalf does some fireworks, and then he slips on back to Bag Inn, and Gandalf meets him there. And they're talking, and Gandalf's kind of, you know, gently prodding, making sure Bilbo's going to go through with his plan. And Bilbo says towards just past the half of the page, on page 32, "I'm old, Gandalf. I don't look it, but I'm beginning to feel it in my heart of hearts. Well preserved indeed," because people say Bilbo is well preserved. He snorted. "Why, I feel all thin, sort of stretched, if you know what I mean, like butter that has been scraped over too much bread." And everybody knows exactly what that looks like. That's how he feels. Okay? So he says he's made up his mind. He's going to go off. He's going to leave the Shire. He's going to see the mountains, see elves, etc., etc. And Gandalf says, "And you're going to leave everything, right? The ring as well?" Top of the next page. Bilbo says, "Yes." And they start to... The conversation starts to get a little pointed. And Bilbo's a bit upset about it. And he feels like Gandalf is badgering him. And Gandalf says, "Well, you know, I had to badger you. I wanted the truth. It was important. Magic rings are, well, magical. You know, and magic isn't ordinary. Even in Middle Earth, it's not like everything is magical. Like there's unicorns and flying fairies all over the place. It's not like that." Okay? So Bilbo starts to get angry, and he says to Gandalf, "If I am, that is, if I am angry, it's your fault. It is mine, I tell you, my own, my precious." And Gandalf is like, "It's been called that before, and not by you." Bilbo knows exactly what Gandalf is talking about. That's what Gollum called the ring. Okay? So Gandalf forces Bilbo to leave the ring on the mantle, right? No, there's no forcing going on. Gandalf is encouraging, he's cajoling, but there's no force involved, nor does he take the ring from Bilbo. Okay? So, Bilbo leaves the ring. In fact, he asks Gandalf, he says, "Why don't you take it?" Gandalf says, "No, don't give it to me, just put it on the mantle, it'll be fine." Okay? So we get the next chapter. Yes?
But he still takes it.
No, he doesn't.
When it drops on the floor, he picks up the package and puts it on the mantle. Is that not how I read it?
Well, it's not. It's not given to him.
I see.
Go back to
Like he says, he twitched.
Gandalf, don't give the ring to me. Put it on the mantelpiece. It will be safe there. Okay. Bilbo took out the envelope, but just as he was about to set it by the clock, his hand jerked back. The packet fell on the floor. Before he could pick it up, the wizard stooped and seized it, set it in its place. Is Gandalf touching the ring?
No.
No, it's in a little envelope. Okay. So, Frodo comes back after the party, and he and Gandalf talk for a little bit. Gandalf says, "You know, Frodo, Bilbo left you something else, the ring." And then Gandalf goes off. He doesn't come back for many years. Chapter 2, Shadow of the Past. And we get at the beginning of the Shadow of the Past, kind of this little description of things going on in the world. Okay, and we see Sam hanging out at the local pub, the Green Dragon. You can go to the one right down off Bridge Street or Main. And we hear about, you know, walking trees. Can I see your hand up?
Yes, sir. I had a question.
Sure.
On page 42, it says the old Took. I don't know how to pronounce
Took.
That.
Mm-hmm.
That's part of Pippin's family. But I don't know, like, is that like of relevance in The Hobbit?
Yes. Bilbo is also descended from the Tooks.
Okay.
His great grandmother, I think, was Belladonna Took.
Okay.
So he has what's called Tookish blood. These are kind of the, if there is an adventurous strain in The Hobbit or in Hobbits, these are them. These are Hobbits that are, you know, maybe not quite right according to the other Hobbits. Okay. In The Hobbit, in fact, we're told when the dwarves come to Bilbo's house and they sing their song about the Misty Mountains, what they do is they awaken the Tookish spirit, which is kind of this adventurous spirit in Bilbo. Okay? So, Gandalf returns after many years. Yeah, after there's, you know, there's been talk about walking trees, the Ents and such. There's talk about elves. Okay? Ted Sandyman, the miller, says some negative things about Bilbo's family. And, you know, Sam's about ready to let's take this outside and get into a fight with him. So Gandalf comes back, and they talk a little bit at night, but he says we should talk about the rest of this in the morning. In other words, what we need to talk about shouldn't be talked about in the dark. Like there's something sinister about the darkness. So the next morning, they're sitting outside and smoking their pipes. And Frodo says, last night you started to tell me some strange tidings about my ring, but you wouldn't continue. You say the ring is dangerous. How so? Gandalf, in many ways, it is far more powerful than I ever dared to think at first. Okay. Notice this. So powerful that in the end, it would utterly overcome anyone of mortal race who possessed it. It would possess him. Okay. Your ring, Frodo, is so powerful that any mortal who tries to possess the ring will become possessed by the ring. Okay, what does any mortal include? Hobbits. So what are we told? We are 46 pages into the novel. Okay. Does Frodo try to possess the ring? What does that mean, to try to possess the ring?
Like use it for its power.
Gandalf doesn't say that.
For himself. Kind of like Bilbo didn't
want to
give it up.
To desire ownership.
Yeah, but Bilbo didn't use it the way Gollum used it. Gollum used it to sneak into people's homes, to kill people. Okay. Bilbo never does that.
Claim ownership?
Doesn't the ring choose you, though?
Well, we're going to get to that. Okay, that the ring has a habit of leaving people and choosing other people. Okay? It would utterly overcome anyone of mortal race who possessed it. What do we usually mean when we say you possess something?
Got it on you.
Yeah, it's yours. You own it. You know, I possess them off. These rings, excuse me, these keys, they're mine. It's not like I can do great, powerful things with them. I can open a few doors, but, okay. It's mere ownership. So, the ring is so powerful that anyone of mortal race who possesses it will ultimately be possessed by it. What is Gandalf / Tolkien telling us at the outset of the novel? Frodo will be possessed by the ring. Unless he can give it up early. Okay. In other words, we're going to find out fairly shortly, Frodo's going to go off on a quest. Will he succeed in that quest? So, Gandalf goes into a history lesson about the making of rings. He talks about the greater rings and the lesser rings. Immortal Frodo, top of page 47. Immortal Frodo, who keeps one of the great rings, does not die, but he does not grow or obtain more life. He merely continues, until at last every minute is a weariness. And if he often uses the ring to make himself invisible, notice it's not only Sauron's ring that makes you invisible. There are other rings that do that. To make himself invisible, he fades. Excuse me, the ring. It is only Sauron's ring. He becomes in the end invisible permanently. Walks in the twilight under the eye of the dark power that rules the rings. Yes, sooner or later, later if he is strong or well-meaning to begin with, but neither strength nor good purpose will last. Sooner or later, the dark power will devour him. Bilbo begins his ownership of the ring with well-meaning. Frodo begins his ownership of the ring with well-meaning. That is, meaning good things, having good intentions. Gollum begins his ownership of the ring. We're going to find out very quickly how.
Murder. Quite ill intentions.
Yeah, quite ill intentions. He murders for it. Okay. How terrifying, says Frodo. How long have you known this? And how much did Bilbo know? Gandalf takes the second question first. Bilbo didn't know any more than he told you. Okay. So, Frodo says again, how long have you known all this? Gandalf, known? I have known much that only the wise know, Frodo. And I think that's Gandalf's kind of a subtle way of slapping Frodo down. Right? Who are you to be asking me how long I have known all this? You know, that adjective all means how long have you known everything that you know? How old is Gandalf? He's old. Let's just put it that way. Thousands of years old. He's not human, first of all. Gandalf is a member of what's called the Istari. These are wizards. Okay? As is Saruman, as is Radagast the Brown. Don't think the stupid movie. The wizards, the Istari, however, are what are called Maiar. Individual one would be a Maia. They're not human. They're not man. They're not elf either. They're Maia. Well, what is a Maia? A Maia is essentially like an angelic being. You never told this in The Lord of the Rings. It's hinted at in the appendices, but you have to read the Silmarillion to get this. The Silmarillion includes Tolkien's story of the creation of everything, the universe. And it begins with, I'm not going to get through the fellowship tonight. I already know that. It begins with Eru Iluvatar, okay? God. The one God. And Eru Iluvatar creates these beings called the Ainur. Ainur, this comes from a Greek thing that means to praise, okay? So he creates these beings called the Ainur. You can kind of think of these as like archangels, if you want, right? And among the Ainur, there are a lesser group called the Maiar. These would be like archangels. The Maiar would be like your everyday, ordinary, run-of-the-mill angel. Okay? The difference between Gabriel, the angel who brings the Annunciation to Mary, and the archangel Michael. Michael, the chief of the heavenly hosts, according to Christian doctrine. Okay, Gabriel's not. Gabriel's, you know, a five and dime kind of an angel. All the word angel means is messenger. He's a postman. All he does is bring messages from God to various people. Okay, so in Tolkien's cosmology, Eru creates them, and he kind of gives each of them individually a song to sing. Okay? And so they start to sing. And there's, I don't know, there's lots of them. Okay? But they're all singing, and you would think you got all these different people singing, it's just going to be nothing but noise. But it's not. It's this beautiful symphony. Until one in particular, whose name is Melchor, starts to put into the song his own ideas, his own themes or motifs into the music. And it's like fingernails on the chalkboard. Okay? So he destroys the music. He brings disharmony into the harmony. And Iluvatar raises his hand. And they stop. You can kind of think of that as the first movement. Okay? They start to sing again. There's harmony at the first. Melchor introduces more discord. Iluvatar allows it to go on for a little bit. He raises his right hand. They stop again. It's the second movement. Third movement, they're all singing, it's all beautiful. Melchor introduces his most discordant note. It's jarring, it's cacophonous, and Iluvatar at this point stands up and kind of goes, you know. The conductor finishes the symphony. And there's silence wherever this is. Okay? It's not described as heaven. Iluvatar at that point says, okay, now let me show you what you've done. You thought you were merely singing this music or creating this music. You weren't. You were creating. Okay? The music that they sang was the creation of everything. The creation of the universe, the creation of what's called Arda or Earth, the creation of elves, okay? And other beings, and the history of the world. Okay? With one little exception, in Tolkien's cosmology, humans have free will. The Ainur song doesn't control what we do. It does control what elves do. Elves don't have free will. Okay? So, Melchor does this, and all Tolkien's doing here is he's showing how God brings good out of evil, etc. Okay? Why did I go into all that? Because Gandalf is one of these. Okay? He's one of these Maiar. Now, at some point, some of the Ainur and Maiar come down into the world that we know, Earth, let's say. When they do that, the big ones, the chief ones, get a new name. They're called Valar. We would call them gods. They essentially match fairly well the Greek and Roman pantheon. Okay, you have gods of vegetation, gods of water, gods of earth, gods of fire, gods of air, etc. Okay. Melchor comes down. He gets a new name too. Morgoth. Okay. Melchor, Morgoth is essentially Satan. So, Frodo says, well, how long have you known all this? And I think when Gandalf says, no, and I've known much that only the wise know, Frodo, because Tolkien has already written a lot of the stories that later become published as the Silmarillion, I think he's got kind of this plan in Gandalf's mind. Who do you think you're talking to, Sonny? He's old. So, but if you mean about the ring, well, you know, I don't really know yet. He says there's still a last test. But when did I first guess? About the time when Bilbo found the ring. Okay. He says, you know, Bilbo's initial stories, they didn't quite. Okay. So they keep talking. And Gandalf tells Frodo, page 49, he says, it would be a grievous blow to the world, this is towards the top of the page, if the dark power overcame the Shire. If all your kind, jolly, stupid, bolgers, hornblowers, boffins, brace girdles, and the rest, not to mention the ridiculous Bagginses, became enslaved. He says it would be horrible for the world if all you stupid, fat, dumb, innocent little hobbits would become slaves. Frodo's like, but why should we? What have we done? Why would Sauron want us as slaves? And Gandalf essentially answers and says, you know, because of malice and revenge. What's malice? Just
hatred.
Down and hatred's good. Down and out meanness. You know, you probably everybody in here has met somebody who just has a mean streak. Okay? You know, the little kid, he starts with pulling legs off and, you know, bugs and stuff, and then moves his way up to cats and dogs, and then little neighbor children, and then on down to big neighbor children, and then people. Psychotic, sociopaths. Revenge? Revenge for what? Frodo asks. He's like, what have I done to Sauron? What does this have to do with the ring? Gandalf, it has everything to do with it. You do not know the real peril yet, but you shall. In other words, I'm going to make clear that your eyes are open and you give me the ring for a moment. Notice the for a moment. That's important. Gandalf doesn't just say, give me the ring, because give me the ring could mean, give me the ring, Frodo. He's not doing that. So, Frodo hands him the ring. Gandalf takes it, he holds it, so Frodo can see it. He says, do you see any markings on it? No, there aren't any. And Gandalf throws it in Frodo's little fire. And Frodo screams, ah, you know, my ring. Gandalf says, chill. He gets some tongs, he reaches into the fire with the tongs, and he tells Frodo, put your hand out. Now, talk about a leap of faith. He's, don't worry, it's cool by now. Drops the ring in Frodo's hands, and Frodo sees this script written on the inside of the ring. And the script reads, Ashnaz Durba Tulak, Ashnaz Gimba Tul, Ashnaz Thraka Tulak, Akburzim Ishi Krimpa Tul. It's the language of Mordor. One ring to rule them all, one ring to find them, one ring to bring them all, and in the darkness, bind them. And Gandalf says, those are two verses of a much longer poem. He tells Frodo then the entire poem and says, this is the one ring. This isn't just a ring of power. This is the ring of power. The object that Sauron poured most of his power into in its creation. He can't get it back. Okay? Frodo, this ring, and he holds it up again, how on earth did it come to me? And Gandalf's like, that's a very long story, so let me start at the beginning. And he kind of reiterates to Frodo about Sauron the Great, and how Sauron has arisen again. And he says, that name even you hobbits have heard of, like a shadow on the borders of old stories. Think of that metaphor for a minute, or that simile for a moment. Like a shadow on the border of old stories. First, start with the end of the clause. Old stories. What often happens to old stories?
They become mystery. Details get a little
bit. Details get a little fuzzy, right? Okay. So you start with the old stories, and then you do what? You go to the outermost edges, the borders of the old stories. Those are the parts that get lost. But he's not even done with the simile yet. Like shadows on the borders of old stories. Okay? Always after a defeat and a respite, the shadow takes another shape and grows again. In other words, evil is not 100% finally destroyed. Ever. Frodo, I wish it need not have happened in my time. Well, duh. I mean, what's he saying? I wish I'd won the lottery. Well, who doesn't? I kind of imagine, you know, when 9/11 happened, Andy Card comes up to President Bush, speaks into his ear and says, Mr. President, we are under attack. I'll bet Bush thought, why me? Why didn't this happen 9 months ago when Clinton was still president? Okay? Gandalf, so do I.
In other words, he doesn't say, come on, Frodo, suck it up, be a hobbit. You know, can't say be a man because he's not. So do I, said Gandalf, and so do all who live to see such times. But that is not for them to decide. Nobody likes to live through horrible times. All we have to decide is what to do with the time that is given us. Notice what Gandalf's statement implies. What must they do? What must Frodo do?
Decide what to do with their time.
Decide what to do. He can't do what?
Nothing.
He can't just say, blah, 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 not my problem, and try to kick the can down the road. In other words, he can't be a traditional politician. All we have to decide is what to do with the time that is given us. And he says, and Frodo, already our time begins to look black. In other words, the darkness is coming. The enemy is fast becoming very strong. His plans are far from ripe. But we have a chance, Frodo. The enemy still lacks one thing to give him strength and knowledge to beat down all resistance, break the last defenses, and cover all the lands in a second darkness. He lacks the one ring. He gets the ring. Can Sauron be stopped? No. So, he goes on, Gandalf goes on, and he talks about the three elven rings of the past. And then he talks about the nine rings given to mortal men who possessed those rings and in turn were possessed by them and turned into ring wraiths. Okay? And he talks about the seven given to the dwarf lords. So he says, Sauron now has the nine gathered to him. The ring wraiths work for him. The three, he doesn't know where they are. The seven are either lost or destroyed, and now the one's been found. And Gandalf says, and this is our chance, Frodo. He believed that as Sauron thought before, that the one had been destroyed. It should have been done, but now he knows it's not perished. Okay? And Frodo asked, but why wasn't it destroyed? How did the enemy ever come to lose it if he was so strong? And Gandalf says, it was strengthened, it was taken from him. Okay? And he talks about what happened to the ring after it was taken from Sauron. It fell into the great river. Only to be discovered several hundred or thousand years later, a couple thousand years later, by Diagol, the hobbit creature swimming in the river, who picks it up, and his best friend Sméagol is right there, who throttles him for it. Okay? And Gandalf relates what he's heard from Gollum. Frodo, page 54. Gollum? Do you mean this is the very Gollum creature that Bilbo met? How loathsome. Gandalf, I think it's a sad story. Notice, Frodo is repulsed by this story. Gandalf feels sorrow for Gollum. Okay? Frodo, I can't believe that Gollum was ever connected to a hobbit. No, this Gollum couldn't have been a hobbit. Why can't Frodo accept that? Why couldn't Gollum be a hobbit?
He doesn't think hobbits are capable of such evil that Gollum committed.
Because we're so good. We couldn't do that. Yes?
I noticed something. Whenever they were talking about that, I couldn't help but thinking about all of his own family members that were coming in, like, screwing up his house and trying to take his things.
Sackville Bagginses, the SBs.
And he's saying that hobbits couldn't steal anything. They couldn't be that evil, but...
Well, I mean, that's all through legal means, except when it wasn't, never mind.
Yeah, it's not all legal means, but, you know, isn't there a difference between coming in and, you know, filching somebody's silverware and killing somebody?
Oh, yeah.
For a ring. I mean, there's a bit of degree of difference, but...
It's like somebody mass murdering a whole bunch of people when we say they're inhuman. They are human, but, you know.
It's exactly the point I was going to get to. What did people say about Hitler? That he was crazy. He was possessed. He was a monster. You don't hear anybody say, you know, anything about what Hitler did was perfectly rational according to Hitler's way of thinking. I mean, think about this. If you accept Hitler's propositions or his assumptions, then what Hitler did makes perfect sense. Or if you accept Stalin's assumptions, the Ukrainians are going to be a problem for me, therefore, kill all the Ukrainians. And he killed an awful lot of Ukrainians. Or Mao Zedong, what he did to the Chinese who opposed him. Okay? What we tend to do with people we find utterly abhorrent to our human nature, we try to dehumanize them. So, World War II, we weren't fighting the Japanese, we were fighting the Japs, or the Nips. We weren't fighting the Germans, we were fighting the Jerrys, or the Krauts. In Vietnam, we weren't fighting the Vietnamese, we were fighting the Gooks. Okay? Notice what goes on there. You dehumanize your enemy. Why? Well, if they're not human, then you can kill them with impunity. You can kill them without any problem whatsoever. Okay? Gandalf says he was a hobbit. How do I know? What do he and Bilbo do? They tell riddles. They knew the same riddles. That implies a cultural connection there. Okay? So anyways, they keep talking, and Frodo's like, well, if Gollum didn't like the ring, why did he keep it? Why did he just get rid of it? Gandalf's smacking him upside the head again verbally. He says, come on, Frodo, you got to understand this by now. Page 55. He had no will left in the matter. What do I mean?
Like particularly bad addiction.
Okay. A mortal who possesses a ring of power will be possessed by the ring of power. Gollum, by the way, when we see him in here, is over 500 years old. In fact, I think he's over 600. And Bilbo feels kind of thin and stretched, and he's 111. The only reason Gollum is 600 years old is because he held the ring for so long. The ring preserved him. It kept him alive. Now that he doesn't have the ring, the clock is ticking faster and faster and faster for him. So, Gandalf explains, a ring of power looks after itself, Frodo. It may slip off treacherously, but its keeper never abandons it. He says, as far as I know, Bilbo is the only one in the history of the ring to ever willingly give it up. Okay? So he finishes that paragraph and he says, the ring left him. The ring left Gollum. What, just in time to meet Bilbo? In The Hobbit. Bilbo's riding on the backs of Dory, a dwarf, and he smacks his head across a lintel, falls on the ground, wakes up hours later. He's kind of stumbling like this, and his fingers come across a ring. He doesn't know what it is. He just picks it up, puts it in his pocket. Okay. Gandalf, it's no laughing matter. It was the strangest event in the whole history of the ring. There was more than one power at work, Frodo. The ring was trying to get back to its master. So notice the powers that are at work. You have the ring. You have Sauron, its master, trying to get the ring back. All right. And Gandalf says, now when its master was awake once more, sending out his dark thought from Mirkwood, it abandoned Gollum. Only to be picked up by the most unlikely person imaginable, Bilbo from the Shire. Behind that, there was something else at work. So you got the ring trying to get back to Sauron. Sauron sending out his dark thought, come back to me, come back to me, come back to me. And Gandalf says, and behind all that, kind of hidden, there was another power at work. I can put it no plainer than by saying that Bilbo was meant to find the ring and not by its maker.
That is, another power intends for Bilbo to find the ring, but not for Sauron. In which case, you also were meant to have it. And that should be an encouraging thought. Yeah, right. I've got Satan's ring, and he wants it back. That's encouraging. Not so much. Okay. Gandalf is saying, this is what should be encouraging. This other power at work behind Sauron. But he never explains what this other power is. Tolkien never explains what this other power is. Read Boethius, and I think you'll get an idea of what Tolkien means by this other power. I usually bring this up later. Tolkien said in one of his letters, said that The Lord of the Rings is fundamentally a Catholic and philosophical work, more so in the revising than in the creating. That is, when he first started writing the story, it wasn't fundamentally Catholic and philosophical. But as he rewrote and rewrote and rewrote and rewrote, and he rewrote the sucker, I think it is 10 or 11 times. You can look at all the drafts. They're at Marquette University in Marquette, Wisconsin. Okay. As he revised, his Catholic kind of consciousness just worked on it. Okay. So what does that mean? According to Boethius, the way we perceive reality is what? And you don't need to know Boethius to answer this question because you all experience this every day. How do we experience everything?
The way we perceive it, the way we understand it.
Yeah, how do we perceive it? How do we understand
it?
Pardon?
Through our senses.
Okay, keep going.
And then experience.
Okay, what else?
Influences.
Okay.
Cultural environment.
Mindset.
Yeah, think even more basic.
Through only our own eyes.
Okay, true. Keep going, though. It's even more basic than that.
By living it?
By living it. Okay, keep going. When does living begin? And when does it end? What is that?
Time.
Time. We experience everything through time. We experience it not all simultaneously. We experience it one thing at a time, a day at a time, a moment at a time, etc. What comes along with that? Our lives are like this. We start here, we move on, we die here. We experience it, how? On this plane, right? Do you ever get an opportunity to go, and look down on yourself? Wouldn't that be cool? Yeah, it could be cool. It could also be scary as hell. We don't see ourselves in terms of this time frame, right? We experience every moment as it comes. So we don't get what?
The big picture.
The big picture. We don't see the big picture of our lives. We can start to see the big picture, but when? When does that occur?
When we're dying.
Well, maybe not necessarily as you're dying. I mean, I'm 54. I kind of think, okay, you know, if this is life, I'm, you know, like here. Okay? Psalmist says you get 3 score and 10. If you're lucky, you get 80. My mom was 82. She died 3 weeks ago. So that's, you know, two-thirds of the way, kind of there, okay? So we experience, you know, it this way, but when we reach certain ages, in other words, when you're 20 and you look back on what you did and thought, etc., when you're 10, you kind of think, oh, that's stupid. And when you're 30, you're going to look back on your 20s, or when you're 20, go, boy, I was really stupid. And then when you're 40, you're going to look back on your 20s and go, lucky I'm still alive. And 50, okay? What does that mean? The longer you live, what? The more you see of the big picture. But it's still the big picture viewed how?
Back.
It's like through a tunnel. It's not the big picture viewed from above. It's like this coat, okay? This coat is woven threads. What does that mean? The threads go like this. Okay, you have what's called the warp and the woof of the threads. They're moving in and out, okay? That's how we experience life. What do we never experience? We see, you know, each of these threads are events, people, experiences, situations that we've had. They all make up our life. But as we're living it, what do we never see? We don't see the pattern. Because we're on the thread, moving. Boethius said, what philosophy taught him, the goddess philosophy taught him, is Boethius, you need to kind of try to get the big picture. The only problem is there's only one person who gets the big picture. Any guesses?
God.
God's the only one who gets the big picture. Why? This is time. Let's make that into a circle. Notice where God is. God is not bound by time. If you accept the traditional understanding of God, God is not bound by time. God is outside time. Time is a creation of God. Okay? So therefore, God's perspective on time is what? This doesn't blow your mind. Nothing will. Okay? Beginning of time, let's say beginning of time, Big Bang, so to speak, in whatever the end of time is. But what's God's perspective?
All of it.
Exactly. All of it simultaneously. In an instant. Our experience is plodding on along. I gotta get up. I gotta go to this damn class. I gotta go to work. I gotta go home. I gotta pay taxes. I gotta vote. You know. Day in, day out. Okay? God's experience is it's all now. So what Boethius came to see is, okay, God is actually the governor of everything. God rules everything. Not because God is the giant chess master and he's moving people into places. He's taking away all their free will, in other words. It's not what Boethius thought. Boethius thought simply because God sees everything is now, God knows exactly what's going to happen. That's the Boethian view of predestination. God sees it all happening now. What does that mean? Sees it all happening now. Creation, Adam falling, Christ hanging on the cross, resurrection, second coming, it's all. What a later writer would call the eternal present. Okay? This brought great relief to Boethius. Because it enabled him to say, okay, my sufferings right now are temporary. And they're connected to what? To events that went on before. Not necessarily events of his own doing, but events of going back to the history of humanity, events going back to Christ, etc., and looking forward. All right? I think that's what Tolkien is getting at with that another power. It's ultimately this. And if it's not Eru Ilúvatar, then it's the chief of the Valar who came down to Earth. A god by the name of Manwë. Right? Yeah, I'm never going to finish. I don't usually go into all that. But. And that may be an encouraging thought. Frodo, no, it's not. Not encouraging at all, he says. I'm not sure I understand you. How have you learned all this about the ring and about Gollum? Do you really know it all, or are you just guessing still? Now, look at that meaning of that. Are you a know-it-all? That's what he's saying. Are you a know-it-all, or are you just guessing? I mean, surprise Gandalf doesn't turn him into a fly or something. Gandalf says, I knew much, and I have learned much. Notice his eyes glint. In Tolkien, whenever somebody's eyes glint, they're pissed off.
They're looking at you with steely eyes, like, you better not do or say that again. He says, but I'm not going to give you an account of all my doings to you. The history of Elendil and Isildur, etc. Okay. And he says, besides, we just read on the ring what it is. That should be proof enough. And he says, oh, and by the way, I talked to Gollum. Frodo, what? You've talked to him? Seems obvious. Okay. So Gandalf explains what he learned from Gollum. And he says, Gollum left the Misty Mountains. Gandalf and his partner, his friend, tracked him down. And they found out Gollum had actually been down to Mordor. And that now probably Sauron has heard of the region of Middle-earth called the Shire and actually knows the name Baggins. So Satan has you in his Rolodex or in his contacts list and is just going to find you now. Silence, bottom of page 58, fills the room. Gandalf, that's right, Frodo. To Mordor. Okay. Frodo says, middle of page 59. This is terrible. Far worse than the worst that I imagined from your hints and warnings. Oh, Gandalf, best of friends, what am I to do? For now, I am really afraid. Sauron knows the name of Baggins. I'm scared you know what. What am I to do? What a pity that Bilbo did not stab that vile creature when he had a chance. I am really afraid. What a pity Bilbo didn't kill Gollum when he had the opportunity. What does he mean by pity?
Shame.
Yeah. What a shame. He had him in his sights. He could have knocked him off. Okay? Look at Gandalf's reply. Pity? It was pity that stayed his hand. In other words, Gandalf questions Frodo's use of that word, pity. At the beginning of The Hobbit, Gandalf shows up at Bilbo's doorstep. And at first, Bilbo is very jovial, convivial. He invites him to sit down, have a smoke. And he says, good morning, like, take a seat. And they talk for a little bit. And Gandalf talks about, you know, an adventure he's planning, and he needs a hobbit to go on this adventure. And Bilbo's like, yeah, we don't like adventures here. We're kind of fat, dumb, and happy people, and that's how we like to stay. And then he says, good morning. And Gandalf says, I can't believe it. Here you use good morning for two totally different meanings. You know, it can mean it is a good morning, or it is a morning to be good on. But now you're using it to mean, go away, I don't want to talk to you anymore. And Bilbo's like, no, not by any means. No. By all means, come back tomorrow. And when he says that, he's giving Gandalf an invitation, etc. Gandalf takes Frodo's pity the same way he took Bilbo's good morning. He's going to quibble on the meaning of that. Pity? It was pity that stayed his hand. In other words, you used the word pity. It was a pity that Bilbo didn't kill him. No, it was pity that stopped him from killing him. Pity in mercy. Okay? Pity's an emotion. Mercy is an action. Not to strike without need. What does that mean, not to strike without need? Did Bilbo need to kill Gollum to get away? No. Obviously not, because he got away without killing him. In The Hobbit, once Gollum realizes Bilbo has the ring on, has made himself invisible, Gollum thinks Bilbo is going to find his way out. He's going to go to the way out of the tunnels. So he runs off to the exit, and Bilbo follows him. And Gollum crouches down in a fissure in the rock that leads to the outside of the mountains. And Bilbo comes to a decision. He can either kill him to get by, or he can try to get by him without killing him. And he decides not to kill him because he feels sorry for him. He knows, after the brief time they've had together, how sorrowful,
how lost this creature is, who lives down at the roots of the mountains all by himself and doesn't have anybody to tell riddles to or talk with. Pity and mercy, not to strike without need. And he has been well rewarded, Frodo. Be sure that he took so little hurt from the evil, that is, from the ring, and escaped in the end because he began his ownership of the ring so, with pity. Okay? Bilbo was able to give up the ring at the end because he began his ownership of the ring with pity, with feeling compassion for someone else, not thinking about his own need.
The good intentions thing coming back.
It's the good intentions thing.
Like shanked the Gollum with Sting and made off with the ring, he'd already be walking down the border by now.
Yeah, he could have. You know, a lot of people read Gollum as a doppelganger. German word means double goer, your twin image, but the opposite of you, your negative. That Gollum is Frodo's negative, his dark side, or Bilbo's dark side, so to speak, or Sam's. Frodo, I'm sorry, but I am frightened. And I do not feel any pity for Gollum. Notice what's really most important there. I'm frightened. I am scared, Gandalf. And I don't feel any pity for Gollum. Why did Bilbo feel pity for Gollum, but Frodo doesn't?
Bilbo saw him.
Bilbo talked with him. He heard how Gollum's mind worked.
Had a nice game of riddles with him.
Played a nice game of riddles with him. Cheated him. The final riddle Bilbo uses isn't a riddle by any means. He breaks all the rules of riddling. Okay. He simply asks, what have I got in my pocket? That's not a riddle. You have not seen him, says Gandalf. I do not feel any pity for Gollum. You have not seen him. Gandalf's implication is, if you see him, you will. No, and I don't want to. Why doesn't Frodo want to see Gollum?
Doesn't want to pity him.
Yeah.
He's frightened.
He doesn't want to feel pity because he's frightened. He wants somebody else to take care of Gollum for him. I can't understand you. Can't or won't? Do you mean to say you and the elves have let him live on after all those horrible deeds? What does that verb let mean? Allowed. What does that imply about Gandalf and the elves?
They have more power.
I mean, they had him captured. Okay. What else does it mean?
They should have killed him.
And
it's led to him being frightened and not being hunted by Sauron.
Okay. It's not just power, though. Frodo seems to be implying that they had the moral right to kill Gollum. Okay? After all those horrible deeds, you and the elves have let him live on after all those horrible deeds. What are all those horrible deeds? What horrible deeds has Gandalf related to Frodo that Gollum did? He murdered Diagol. He murdered anybody else, as far as we know?
They said he crawled through windows and...
Didn't say he crawled through windows and ate babies.
Said something about the cradle, though.
He stole things. Yeah, I mean, he robbed birds' nests.
Spy.
He was a spy. I'm not saying Gollum was a nice person. Okay? He ate orcs. We definitely know that. But it's okay to eat orcs. It's okay to slaughter orcs. Orcs have no redeeming value whatsoever. At all. There's nothing good about an orc. Period. Nothing that can be redeemed. Okay? So all those horrible deeds. So he killed Diagol. He robbed and he thieved and he spied on his people. Okay, I guess you can count those as horrible. What else? He went and told Sauron about the name of Baggins.
In other words, he put Frodo in danger.
Do we know that for certain that he told them that he did? Are we just assuming that at this point? Because obviously Sauron knows the name, but...
No, Gandalf does say.
I didn't know if he says it.
It might not come up here. This might come up in the Council of Elrond. Hold on a second.
I just didn't know if Gollum said it outright or if we're just kind of assuming that.
No, he said it outright.
Okay.
Yeah. Yeah. So Gandalf goes on. Excuse me, Frodo goes on. After all those horrible deeds. Now, present tense. At any rate, he is as bad as an orc. Now remember what I just said about orcs. Orcs have no redeeming qualities. They can't be purified. They can't be made good. Orcs, you got to go back to the Silmarillion and Melkor Morgoth and what he did. Orcs are bred from twisted, bent, broken elves that Morgoth captured. And they became so bent, twisted, that they became un-elves, essentially. So orcs are creatures that have been around for thousands of years. And there's nothing good left at all. So what has he said? Now at any rate, he is as bad as an orc. Orcs, as I said, can be killed willy-nilly. And just an enemy. What does that word just mean?
Only.
When I look at Gollum, all I see is enemy. What does that mean? He's got a bullseye on. Why do enemies exist? To be killed. Enemies exist to be killed. Enemies don't exist because they want their own way of life. Nah. Enemies, properly understood by that term, exist solely to be destroyed. You get rid of your enemies, and then your way of life is fine and happy. Okay? He deserves death. What has Frodo just done? Condemned him. Thank you for using that word. What does that word condemn mean? No.
There's no chance for redemption.
It's a judgment.
Past moral judgment.
Yeah, he has judged Gollum. Condemned means damned with. Okay? He has damned Gollum. Okay? Gandalf deserves it? I dare say he does. You're right, Frodo. He probably does. Many that live deserve death. Okay. We could probably name a few folks. Depending on your political perspectives, we could have a lot of fun. Because some of you would go, you know, you'd kill all the right-wingers, and others would say, kill all the left-wingers, and you know, nobody would be left. Many that live deserve death. And some that die deserve life. Now you can stop here and think, okay, give me an example of some that die who deserve life.
A child with cancer.
Child with cancer. It's not right, right? No parent should have to bury their child. That's not how it's supposed to work. This thing is supposed to work, you know. Parents have children, parents get old, die, children goes on. Children have children, but you know, and the cycle keeps going. Not supposed to work the other way around. Okay? What else? Idiots taking control of planes and flying them into buildings. The people in the buildings and the non-idiots in the planes. Okay? George Carlin famously joked, you know, it might not be my time to die, but what if it's the pilots? But that's not what Gandalf is talking about. He's not necessarily talking about people who get tragic illnesses and die young. Where people walk in across the street and get killed by a car. Where people stopping, as happened last weekend during the snowstorm in Virginia. People stopping because a car looks like it's broken down on the side of the road. They get out to help the person on the side of the road and they say we should call the police, and the guy gets out of the car and unloads a revolver into the lead
Good Samaritan's chest simply because he said we should call the police. That guy was simply trying to help. Okay? No. What is Gandalf getting at? Some that die deserve life. Can you give it to them? Then do not be too eager to deal out death in judgment. He's talking about death in judgment. Okay? He's talking about capital punishment. But what's the most important word or phrase in that sentence?
Can you give it to them?
Nope, that's previous.
Judgment.
Too eager.
Too eager. What does it mean to be eager?
Really
excited? You really want to? What else does it imply?
That you think and do things irrationally.
Okay. Hasty. There's a time component to eagerness. I want it now. I want it done now. I can't wait. Okay. Then do not be too eager to deal out death in judgment. Don't be too rash to deal out death in judgment. Why? Because some that die deserve life. Can you give it to them? What happens if you deal out death in judgment too eagerly and you're wrong?
You can't get it
back. Oops! My bad! But your heart keeps on ticking and the other person's dead. I mean, just kind of let that percolate for a moment. That's a pretty powerful statement. Especially given what we know, what we've been told, Gollum has done. He has committed murder. Not negligent homicide. This was out and out, premeditated, first degree murder. He might not have planned it for 3 weeks, but as soon as he saw that ring, he knew what he wanted. And that's premeditated. Okay. Then do not be too eager to deal out death in judgment. Why? For even the very wise cannot see all ends. What does he mean by ends? He means partially this.
The outcome.
The end of something, the outcome of something, the completion, the finality of it. But he also means this sense. The purpose or intention of something. Okay? Like, what's the end point? That's not what's the completion. It means, what's the purpose of this? We talk about means and ends, or something is the means to an end. The end there is the purpose. Okay? You've heard the phrase, do the ends justify the means? Tolkien is going to suggest, I think pretty strongly throughout the Lord of the Rings, no. Hell no. Emphatically no. Because if the ends justify the means, that is, if your purpose... here, sorry. If your purpose is so noble and good that you can use whatever means to reach that purpose, then why doesn't Gandalf claim the ring? He could use the ring. He could destroy Sauron. Sauron, by the way, is one of these. He's a Maia also. So is Saruman. So is the Balrog that we're going to meet later on. Okay? Yes?
Is everybody on the council of Maia?
No. You mean the White Council?
Yes,
yeah, no. Galadriel isn't, for example. Galadriel's a member of the White Council. She's just an elf. Really, 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 really old one, but she's an elf. Okay? So, Tolkien's going to raise this question. For even the wise, even the very wise, cannot see all ends. Okay?
I have not much hope that Gollum can be cured before he dies, but there is a chance of it. Notice the ends he's talking about is Gollum's end, his death. And what is he saying? What does he hope Gollum finds before he dies?
Peace.
Redemption.
Self-forgiveness.
Louder?
Self-forgiveness.
Self-forgiveness, that he dies and goes, I'm sorry, I forgive myself. Is it really self-forgiveness?
We're going to hear Frodo say something at the end. It's not self-forgiveness. Okay? What's the word Tolkien uses?
I have not much hope that Gollum can be
cured.
Cured.
Of the ring's curse.
Is it of the ring's curse? What does that imply?
He's sick.
He's sick. Gollum is sick. He's ill. Do we blame somebody if they get ill? Unless you're crazy. Okay? And I don't mean, you know, you don't blame people for getting crazy. I mean, unless you're one of these crazy people who blame people that they've gotten ill because it's some secret sin they've done. Or, oh, you have AIDS because you're gay. I had a friend in college who got AIDS, but he is a hemophiliac. And he got a bad blood transfusion. 23 years old. Dead by the time he was 26. Okay? Had nothing to do with lifestyle. Okay? Cure. Cure implies not being whole, not being healthy. What does Gandalf hope for Gollum?
He can become whole again.
Yeah. That he can become whole, healthy, in his right mind. Okay? Why? Why does he want Gollum to be whole and healthy and cured before he dies?
So he's aware of what happened.
So that he's aware? It's a good question. You know, various states, somebody's on death row, if they have a mental illness, and it's a mental illness that can be corrected with drugs, before that person can be executed, they will be administered drugs so that their mental illness is in check so that they are aware of why they're being executed. I don't know about you. To me, that's a little crazy. And I, you know, I think I've said before, I'm really right-wing. I mean, I'm really far conservative. Ted Cruz isn't conservative libertarian enough for me. Rand Paul's kind of there, etc. I mean, to the right of Genghis Khan. Think of it that way. Okay? But over the last 20 years, and largely because of teaching this, my ideology towards capital punishment and stuff has really shifted a lot. Okay? Because of these questions that Tolkien is raising. It's not necessarily so that Gollum will suddenly go, oh, I'm such a horrible person, oh, you know, and die. But he'll have this self-revelation. It's not that. What does Gandalf want?
He wants him to find God. Find.
Okay. I'm not going to go that far. How else do we use that word cure? We actually use it for food.
Oh, you cure meat.
You cure meat. What does that mean, though?
Preserve.
You're preserving it for. You're saving it. Okay, Tolkien doesn't choose any word by accident or randomly. Because he's going to use a word later. He's going to use the word later, saved. He doesn't want to use it here. Okay? And I think he doesn't want to use it here because he's in the revising. He's not trying to be overt. He's not trying to write a Christian story. But he can't help himself in terms of some of his thinking coming out. He wants Gollum to be saved. Not in a sense where he's on his dying deathbed and he goes, oh, Jesus, come into my heart and save me. Albert. Not in that sense. In the Middle Earth sense, however. Okay? Now, it is going to be interesting. We're going to get to the very end, and we are going to have Frodo forgive Gollum.
very end. Not quite at the very end, when the ring gets destroyed. Frodo forgives Gollum, and he says to Sam, Sam, I couldn't have done it. Or the quest would not have been achieved were it not for Gollum. We should forgive him. Okay? I think that's all from Tolkien's Catholic thinking. If we forgive others their sins, what? According to Christian doctrine, they are forgiven. If we forgive someone else's sins, their sins are forgiven them. If we hold somebody else's sins against them, that is, if we don't forgive them their sins aren't forgiven. But Christ also says, likewise, if you don't forgive somebody else their sins, your sins aren't forgiven. Okay, so, you know, it's in your own best interest to forgive other people. Forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us, the Lord's Prayer says. Okay? Is Frodo getting all of this? Is he understanding all of this? I have not much hope that Gollum can be cured before he dies, but there is a chance of it. And Gandalf is going to offer the same hope to others throughout the course of the novel. He's going to offer that same chance, for example, to Saruman. And he is bound up with the fate of the ring. My heart tells me that he has some part to play yet, for good or ill, before the end. And when that comes, the pity of Bilbo may rule the fate of many, yours not least. And I always imagine Frodo thinking there, yeah, but what if the part he has to play is ill? I mean, it's all well and good to say he has some part to play, and it may be good. But what if it's not? What if he steals the ring from me and it goes back to Sauron and darkness falls upon the universe? Well, damn, we should have killed him when we had the chance. No. In any case, we did not kill him. He is very old and very wretched. Frodo. Okay, so you and Bilbo couldn't kill Gollum. I wish he had not kept the ring. Here we are again. I wish Bilbo hadn't kept the ring. Gandalf's like, hello, are you listening? What's Bilbo going to do? Why did you let me keep it? Why didn't you make me throw it away or destroy it? Let you? Make you? Have you been listening? You couldn't destroy the ring. You couldn't throw it away. Come on, come on, try. Come on, take the ring out. Frodo pulls the ring out of his pocket, looks at it, and Gandalf laughs at him. That grimly, we're told. Gandalf laughed grimly. It's kind of like, you little sucker. You're already in its power. You see already, you two, Frodo, bottom of page 60. Cannot easily let it go, nor will to damage it. And I couldn't make you. If I did, I would destroy your mind. And your little fire doesn't even heat it up, and no hammer can damage it. And nor is there a fire or a dragon around with a fire hot enough to melt it. No, no, no. You want to destroy it? There's one way to destroy it. March into Sauron's backyard and drop it in the cracks of doom where it was forged. That's the only way. Page 61. I do really wish to destroy it, cries Frodo. What kind of sentence is that? Think voice, if you know what voice is. It's active voice. The subject is performing the action of the verb. I do wish to destroy it. It's Frodo taking a stand, you know, flexing his whatever muscles he has. Or, well, to have it destroyed, completely flips the voice. Goes from active voice to passive voice. Or, well, to have it destroyed. Who will be the destroyer?
Y'all.
I don't really care, as long as it's not me. It's not I. It's some faceless, nameless person. You know, you get in trouble, you're a little kid, you break something at home, you break a vase, and your parent comes in, and what do you say? The vase broke. Really? On its own. It was just sitting there and poof, you know. It's like you hear news reports. You know, an SUV ran into a crowd of people and killed 12. Really? All on its own? There wasn't a driver behind the wheel? Because SUVs don't normally do that.
Friggin' self-driving cars.
Yeah, well, you know, give Google and Apple enough time and they'll rule or destroy the world.
Or both.
Yeah. Or, well, to have it destroyed. I am not made for perilous quests. I wish I had never seen the ring. Why did it come to me? Why was I chosen? Gandalf should just say, Frodo, go back to page 50, whatever it is. Such questions cannot be answered. Notice what Gandalf doesn't say. Oh, there, there, Frodo. He doesn't sit him down, pat him on the back, fix him a cup of tea, and say, it'll be all right. Everything's going to be okay. No, he doesn't. You're going to see when we get to the Harry Potter stories. Harry witnesses some pretty horrible things. Dumbledore never says, oh, it's okay, Harry. You'll take a nice long nap and you'll get up tomorrow and you'll feel better. Uh-uh. He says, Harry, man, you acted like a man there. Now I've got to ask you to be even more of a man and relive it. You need to tell me everything that happened. Don't leave anything out. Don't skip any of the gory details. Why? Because you need to understand what happened to you. Gandalf, such questions cannot be answered. Why did it come to me? Why was I chosen? What does he really mean? Two words. Why me? Maybe three. God. Or karma, or, you know. Why me? Gandalf / Tolkien, you can't answer that question. It's like survivor guilt. You know, train wrecks, one person lives, and that person wonders, well, why did I live? Plane crashes, you were supposed to be on the plane, and you're late for your flight. You know, you read all kinds of stories of survivor guilt. Gandalf, you may be sure it was not for any merit that others do not possess. It's not for some unique quality you have, Frodo. It's not you're some Marvel comic book superhero hidden inside that little 3-foot short, fat, and dumb body. Or at least, Gandalf says, not for power or wisdom at any rate. He's definitely demonstrated he doesn't have much wisdom. He's 3 feet tall. How much power can he really have? We're not talking Ant-Man here. But you have been chosen. Notice what that means. Does Frodo have a choice? No. Nope. Frodo does not have a choice. Shakespeare, in one of his plays, says, some people are born to greatness, something else, but some people have greatness thrust upon them. It's like, here's an example, Winston Churchill was born to become Prime Minister of Great Britain in 1939. He was born for that reason. Soon as World War II ended, the British populace elected him out of office. They did not want him in office. They wanted to go back to their socialist ways. They wanted a good, strong conservative during the war because he knew how to kick ass, because he'd been in the military. Not necessarily great strategician all the time, okay? So what's Gandalf's point? But you have been chosen, and you must therefore use such strength and heart and wits as you have. What does he mean? Come on, Frodo. You have some strength. You have some heart, courage. You have some intelligence. You make do with what you've been given. Frodo, but I have so little of any of these things. Is this Frodo being false, humble, showing false humility? No. I think Frodo here is being deadly honest. I don't have any heart. I'm a chicken. I don't have, as I've shown, much wits. Strength,
He's fat and flabby. He's saying, I can't do this. You are wise and powerful. Will you not take the ring? Why does he offer the ring to Gandalf? So he doesn't have to deal with it. Why else?
He's scared.
Trust Gandalf. He trusts Gandalf. Why else? What is everything Gandalf been saying about the ring? Keep going.
It's gonna be destroyed.
It's evil, and what does the ring have?
Power.
Keep going.
Over him.
What is the ring trying to do?
Return to Sauron.
It's trying to return to Sauron. What's a better way to return to Sauron? Stay in Frodo's possession, or become the possession of Gandalf the Grey? I think the ring is now, right here. The ring is trying to kind of make itself known. Not to Gandalf and Frodo, they already know about it. But if Gandalf accepts this temptation, look at what he says. No! He cries, springing to his feet. Why? Because he and Frodo have kind of been sitting together like this. And he jumps back. He wants to get as far away from the ring as he can. Why? With that power, I should have power too great and terrible. Well, there's a new idea. How can you have too much power? I mean, the whole history of the 20th century is essentially, you can never have enough power, especially if you're a nation. You want to achieve power. Why? So that nobody else will bother you. Or, flip side, so you can bother other people. With that power, I should have power too great and terrible. Lord Acton is reputed to have said, power corrupts. What's the rest of the quote?
Absolute power corrupts absolutely.
Absolute power corrupts absolutely. And over me, the ring would gain a power still greater and more deadly. His eyes flash. His face was lit as by a fire within. Why? Because it's probably his inner nature kind of coming out, I think. Do not tempt me, for I do not wish to become like the Dark Lord himself. Notice what Gandalf says the ring will do to him. Yeah, Sauron will be overthrown. But what will they get instead?
Gandalf
2.0. Okay, yeah. Gandalf the Black.
So are you saying that the ring kind of led Frodo to making that
yes,
statement?
Yes. Okay. I think the ring prompted Frodo to say that. Will you not take the ring? Okay. Notice what he says. You are wise and powerful. Gandalf said, you weren't given the ring because of power or wisdom at any rate. Frodo, or the ring, takes those two qualities and says, well, you've got power and you've got wisdom. You should take the ring. Notice Gandalf says, you weren't chosen for those things. In other words, whatever this other power is, it didn't choose Bilbo and Frodo because of those. Why? Because it's not power in wisdom that will destroy the ring. It's something else. Yes?
I was going to say, like, when Bilbo was trying to put the ring on the mantle, he said, wouldn't it be better safe with you than sitting on the mantle? Is that also, like, an example of the ring?
Could be. Yeah, and Gandalf says, no, don't give it to me. Just leave it there. I do not wish to become like the Dark Lord himself. Yet the way of the ring to my heart is by pity. Notice, not by power. Pity for weakness and the desire of strength to do good. Gandalf looks around the world and he sees a lot of problems. He sees a lot of sorrow. He feels, to kind of quote Bill Clinton, he feels their pain, as it were. And with the ring, what could he do? A lot of good. The ring gives you power to achieve your ends. With one little caveat.
The ring also has an end.
The ring also has an end. And all of those ends that are achieved are tainted.
By the means.
Yeah, by the means. And the means is like a virus. The virus doesn't go dormant. The virus spreads. And so whatever good would be achieved by the ring ultimately would become bad. You know, here's an example. If the ends justify the means, why don't we take advantage of the research that the Nazi doctors performed on Jews and homosexuals and gypsies and Christians? Because a lot of the research that they performed did come up with findings, did come up with solutions to problems. So why don't we use it? Why are we willing to use fetal stem cell research, but not that? In order to use fetal stem cell research, what must you do? You must produce a fetus. Okay? But we won't use this over here. Why not? Because this over here was so horrible. It was so monstrous. Because the Jews or the homosexuals or the gypsies or the Christians that had these experiments performed on them, you know, they weren't anesthetized. And some of the experiments were extremely grotesque. Okay?
Can I ask kind of an offhanded question?
Sure.
Does the ring know, obviously it knows, but does it know Sauron is its only master since it was, or he was its creator?
Yes.
Or, so there's no chance that because Sauron and Gandalf both come from that fire, that it could
No, because Gandalf's going to tell us. I think we get this in the Shadow of the Past. It might have already been said, or it's going to come up in Council of Elrond. Sauron poured most of his power. So it's his essence.
Okay.
His being.
There's no chance the ring.
That powers the ring. So, you know, it's like the ring recognizes its DNA,
okay,
so to speak. Okay?
Yep.
Yeah.
I think I get the whole, why don't we just use the Nazi research? Because it was so horrible. And even if it's not our generation, or the next one after that, somewhere down the line, someone's going to be like, you know, all this Nazi research brought out so much good. Let's do some more.
Yeah, and I mean, and that's why I think Tolkien is raising this question. Do the ends, the good ends, ever justify the ways that you achieve those ends?
No, because if you reach a good end with horrible means, that's just an excuse to do horrible means all over again.
Yeah, I mean, if, you know, you've got people who need kidneys, then why not, you know, just start harvesting people who are in permanent vegetative states? Why not keep those people alive solely so that we can start taking body parts from them?
Because human body parts are icky.
And that does happen in some places. And we now have accounts we know where ISIS, you know, the madmen of the Middle East, have harvested body parts from living captives that they have. Not, you know, like Western captives, but Yazidi people and other Arabs that they've captured. Okay? They're sending doctors in and removing kidneys and removing livers and removing spleens. So why not, you know, who did the book on that? Michael Crichton, I think, did a novel. Michael Crichton was a scientist and a medical doctor. He wasn't just a hack novelist. He was a good novelist. Because every one of his novels is based upon an idea of what if we allowed the scientists to, okay? And one of his novels, I think it was Coma, in fact, was about people keeping other people in a comatose state for the simple reason of harvesting parts of their bodies. So if we can do that, if we can give other people normal lives, then why not? Because there's something still inside us that says, that's wrong. That's why not. Okay? So, Gandalf says, do not tempt me. I dare not take it, not even to keep it safe, unused. Why the wish to wield it would be too great for my strength. He knows. I'd want to use it, and I'd give in. What's Gandalf showing there? Wisdom.
Resisting temptation.
Okay. Resisting temptation. He's showing his strength, but he's also showing extreme humility. I can't control this thing. You give it to me, I'm going to use it. Eventually, I'm going to use it, and I'm not going to use it in a good way. Okay? So there's a long silence. Yes?
So I get the use of the ring. The initial effect is turning invisible, but what, you know, when Sauron uses it, he's not completely invisible.
No.
We've seen that he, what other abilities does
well,
he ever say?
Well, you know, that I think is a, I don't want to say that's a problem. I don't know how to account for that.
Okay.
The fact that Isildur could see Sauron when Sauron wore the ring. Tolkien never explains that. Anybody else puts on the ring, with one exception. Anybody else puts on the ring, poof, they're invisible. So how could Isildur see Sauron when he had the ring on?
It's not like the ring wraiths. Like they've got their own rings. And they've turned into wraith, but he doesn't actually see them as they are.
Yeah, so I mean, it could be that.
Are into the wraith state or whatever.
Yeah. They're cloaked. It's their cloaks that you see.
Their cloaks, yeah. You see the horses.
Yeah. Sauron had on armor, so maybe it's that. Okay. Tolkien never tells us what other power. But we are told, in order to use the power of the ring, you have to have a power commensurate to wield it. It's kind of like when the false Professor Moody in the fourth Harry Potter book tells all the students, you know, you all can whip out your wands and you could do the Avada Kedavra curse, which is the killing curse. And you could all say Avada Kedavra, and I wouldn't get any more than a nosebleed, probably. Why? Because they don't have the collective power. Okay. Later on, towards the end of the novel, I'm going to give it away. Frodo's going to get to Mount Doom. He's going to get to Orodruin and the cracks of Doom, and he's going to say, I have come, but I choose now not to do the thing I came to do. The ring is mine. He claims the ring for himself. Why? Because any mortal that possesses the ring for long enough will be possessed by the ring. Okay? But he doesn't suddenly grow into Arnold Schwarzenegger in 1977. He's still 3 feet tall. He's lost a lot of weight. He's trimmed. He's gotten hobbit buff. But that's about it. He doesn't suddenly have great power. Because he's still a midget. Sauron was created with great power. Frodo wasn't. If Frodo were to say, Sauron, you and me, Maioro Hobbito, you know, rather than mano a mano, you and me, two go in, one come out. Who's going to come out? Sauron's still going to come out. All he's going to do, he's going to go up to Frodo and, you know, flick him off the existence plane. Okay.
You need to get out the beating stick.
Yeah, it's... So, Gandalf finally says, page 62, there's only 300-some pages left to go, an hour and a half. So, he says, what are you going to do, Frodo? What are you thinking about? Notice, he doesn't tell Frodo what to do. In the film, he tells Frodo, you need to go to Rivendell. No. He doesn't even suggest Rivendell. Frodo. I suppose I'm going to keep the ring and guard it, at least for the present. Whatever it may do to me, Gandalf says, whatever it does, it'll be slow, as long as you don't use it. Right? Frodo, okay. Meantime, I'm a danger to everyone that I'm near. I cannot keep the ring and stay here. I ought to leave Beggin, leave the Shire, leave everything and go away. Why? Because he says, to save the Shire. What does he mean by save? Think of this. The two are related. He said, I used to think that, you know, the Shire could use a good shaking up. It could use an earthquake or a whole bunch of drive-ins coming in. But now I don't feel like that. I feel that as long as the Shire lies behind, safe, comfortable, I shall find wandering more bearable. I shall know that somewhere there is a firm foothold, even if my feet cannot stand there again. In other words, Frodo is saying that as long as the Shire is like this, he'll be on a tether and he'll wander around. But what will the Shire always serve as for him?
He'll go home.
It'll be an anchor. He can go home, and it will be what? Safe and comfortable, and the same. That's what Frodo thinks he's doing when he says, I'm going to take the ring and I'm going to leave the Shire. He's going to preserve it. What does Frodo not yet understand?
Can't go home.
Can't go home. You can't preserve it. You can't stop time. Ever. No matter how much you want to. Time rolls inexorably on. And he says, you know, I've thought of going away before. I've thought of going off, finding Bilbo, seeing elves, having adventures. And Gandalf's like, you know, you can think you know everything there is to know about hobbits, and then they'll surprise you. And he says, I never expected this from you. So what do you expect? Well, I'll dig a hole in the ground, and I'll put it there, and I'll sit on it, you know, and I'll protect it. Gandalf doesn't tell us, but he says, I hardly expected to get such an answer, not even from you. Okay? Says, the ring can't stay hidden in the Shire much longer. Says, and I don't think you should go out with the name of Baggins. Let me give you a nickname or a new name. We'll call you Underhill. Why? Because he lives under the hill. But he says, you don't need to go alone. You should take those that you trust. And he reaches out the window and he pulls in Sam Gamgee. Why? Because Gandalf has noticed Sam's trimming the weeds has stopped. Why did Sam stop trimming the weeds? He was eavesdropping. Why was he eavesdropping?
Because that was a really interesting conversation about that ring.
What did he hear that really intrigued him?
Elves.
Elves. Sam wants to see elves. What's that tell us? Elves are as foreign to hobbits. Think of something that's really foreign to us today. Something you would really like to see. Maybe that you're not even sure is real, but you think it is. Sam has heard stories of elves, but he's never seen any. I've heard stories of alien abduction. I've never seen any aliens. Don't really want to, necessarily. Or at least not up close and personal. I mean, here's an example. I always used to want to see a tornado. I wanted to see a tornado. I'm from California. Earthquakes, psh, earthquakes are nothing, okay? But tornadoes, man, those are cool. Until 6 years ago, 2010, the Good Friday earthquake, I was at the end of my street. I was getting ready to go to an appointment, getting ready to turn left on Highway 96, and all these cars are pulling over to the right. I'm like, what in the world's going to think? You know, maybe there's an emergency vehicle. Lots of thunderstorms in the area. I turn, look to the right, and there, not 400 yards away, is this big, massive black V. Making a beeline straight for me. I mean, literally, coming straight at me. Jam the car in reverse, back home, about 200 yards. Get in my house, get all my kids in the closet, and I go out because I'm a damn fool. I stand on the front porch and watch this thing. Come down the end of my street, not on the ground, just above. I look up, and there's all kinds of stuff swirling up. But it hits the house at the end of the street, bounces a few more, and then that's when it really lands in the Blackman area, and just takes off. I'm like, okay, I don't need to see another one. That's one is enough. Okay. Sam wants to see elves. Who wouldn't? When you think of the stories Bilbo has told, and you think of the elves that we meet in the tale. So, Sam is now part of Bilbo's group. So, three is company. We're going to zip through some of this really fast. Three is company. Frodo decides to sell Bag Inn. He's going to sell it to the SBs. I love Tolkien's humor. And he's going to move off to Buckleberry, to the land of the Tooks. So they get everything packed up. Frodo, Sam, and Pippin get in the cart. They make their way. Notice they leave at night. Sam overhears a conversation his father has when he goes to leave the keys. And his father's being interviewed, asked questions by a man in black. Okay? That's the closest we really see to the Dark Riders being after them. We get that other instance when they go into the Old Forest and they see the Dark Riders. Okay? But are they ever chased by them where they have to hide under tree roots and stuff like in the stupid film? No. If the Dark Riders ever got that close, Frodo would be toast. The pull of the ring would be so powerful that the Black Riders would not miss them. Okay? So they go off to Frodo's new home. I'm going to skip a bunch. And the conspiracy is unmasked. What's the conspiracy? Frodo, we know all about the ring. We know you're leaving the Shire for good. We're coming with you. Frodo, Sam, Merry, and Pippin. Okay? So they leave the Shire and they go off on a shortcut. What happens with shortcuts all too often?
They're not so
sure.
They take longer. You know, but this kind of shortcut, this isn't like, you know, you're on a road shortcut. This is a shortcut like my dad and brother and I used to do when we would hike at Yosemite National Park. And we'd go off in the backcountry. We'd go off the trails. We're like, okay, well, if we want to get to this point, let's just go up over that ridge. Okay, it should only take 4 hours, and it takes 10 hours.
Cut east.
Yeah, but it's not as long a distance, so it's a shortcut. Takes longer, less distance, though. So they go off into the Old Forest, where they are promptly captured by Old Man Willow. But Tom Bombadil comes and rescues them and takes them to his home. And they get cleaned up. And one evening in Tom's home, pages 130, 131, Tom starts to tell them a story. Right? Not really a story. He starts to tell them history. And they kind of fall asleep and go in and out of consciousness. And they're wondering, how long have we been here? Has this been one night, two nights, what? And they notice Tom looks like he's asleep. And Frodo finally asks, who are you, Master? Tom. Eh? What? Don't you know my name yet? That's the only answer. Tell me, who are you? Alone. Yourself. And nameless. First, are you ever alone? Yourself. Nameless. What does that mean to be nameless? Doesn't mean to not remember your name. It means to not have a name. Where do you get your name from?
Your parents.
Your parents. Maybe the government.
Other people.
Other people. But not if you are alone yourself. Alone doesn't just mean you're the only person in the room. He means by alone, you're it. There's nobody else. Anywhere. Anywhere. Who are you without anybody else? Who are you without any relation to anybody else? That's the only answer. I am old. Excuse me, you are young, and I am old. How old is Tom? Eldest. That's what I am. Eldest. It's superlative. That means nobody's older. He's not like I'm mostly eldest. How old is that? Mark my words, my friends. Tom was here before the river and the trees. Okay. We all know topography changes. Trees, forests rise and die. Rivers come and go. Might be eons, but, I mean, we've already met people who are thousands of years old. Gandalf. So maybe he's just really, really old. Tom remembers the first raindrop and the first acorn. Okay, that's pretty old. He made paths before the big people. The big people were elves and men. Before they were awakened by Manwë. And he saw the little people arriving, the hobbits and such. He was here before the kings and the graves and the Barrow-wights. When the elves passed westward, Tom was here already. What's he talking about? He's talking about the stories that get published as the Silmarillion. Okay? Very, very briefly. I'll try. Originally, the world was flat. The world that Eru Iluvatar, through the singing of the Ainur, creates is flat. Okay? And on one side over here, you've got the Isle of Valinor. And after that isle, the water just flows off the edge of the earth. And over on this side, you have Middle Earth. And in between them, you have an island named Numenor. Okay? Where he's talking about the big people, the elves and men being awakened, that's over here in Middle Earth. The gods live, the Valar, live over here. Okay? So he says, I was here when the elves passed from here to over here. They built boats, and they sailed over, and they lived with the gods for a while. And they were illumined, enlightened, you could say, by the gods. He says, I was here when the elves and men awakened. I was here before the first raindrop fell. He says, Tom was here already before the seas were bent. See, the seas were bent, this flat plain, was bent by Eru Iluvatar to stop people from over here from ever again reaching here without his will. So now, this becomes this. And if you try to sail from here to here, you just go around in circles. In order to get to here, you got to kind of do what Peter Pan does. Go off to the second star to the right, off to Neverwhere. And then he says the last sentence. He, Tom, knew the dark under the stars when it was fearless, before the Dark Lord came from outside. Well, when was that? The sun. Not Sauron. Before the Dark Lord.
Well, that was the fall of Melkor.
Melkor. It's before Melkor enters what is called, all of this is called Arda, Earth. Okay. After the Ainur sing their three symphonies, and Eru Iluvatar stands up and says, okay, now let me show you what you've sung. And he gives them a vision, and then he says, Ea, which in Elvish or in the language means, let it be. And he makes it real. He gives it physicality. Okay? He says, this is what you've wrought. And he shows them all this. He shows them the history of humanity, beginning to end. Okay? And at that point, Melkor's like, I'm going to go down there and I'm going to screw it up. I'm going to screw it up. Okay? I think that's what Tom means when he says, I was here before the Dark Lord came from outside. Okay? Melkor was the first one into Arda. Manwë and the other Valar come after him to stop him from screwing everything up. Okay, so if Tom was here before then, what could that make Tom? That's what I've come to think. Tom is a manifestation, a theophany of God. He's like a manifestation of God's creative spirit. What does the book of Genesis say? And the spirit of God, what? Hovered upon the face of the deep. I kind of wonder if this is more of Tolkien's Catholicism coming through. All Tolkien ever says about Tom Bombadil, in one of his letters, he says, Tom is an embodiment, an incarnation of pacifism, kind of the pacifist spirit, okay? Might be helpful to know that when Tolkien was writing The Lord of the Rings and revising The Lord of the Rings in the late 40s, he also wrote The Adventures of Tom Bombadil. and published it as a little separate book. And it's songs and poems, and there's silly songs like Tom Bombadil sings in here. All these stupid rhymes and stuff. Okay? He's prancing, hopping about in the forest and singing to frogs and, you know, Goldberry and all this nonsense. And it's like he comes to this part in the novel and he just takes Tom Bombadil out of this entirely other creation. The Adventures of Tom Bombadil are not set in Middle Earth. And he takes Tom Bombadil and is like, he just plops him right in the middle. Okay. Not quite sure how he fits. So anyways, they have that little discussion. Tom sends them on their way. He warns them about the Barrow Downs. He says, stay away from the standing stones. That is, you see Stonehenge, look at it from a distance, but don't go up to it. And what do the hobbits do? They go right up to it. Not intentionally, it's foggy. They can't see. Okay. They get captured by the Barrow-wight, and Tom comes and rescues him after Frodo sings the song. He removes everything from the Barrow. A Barrow is a burial mound. Okay. Go to England today, you see them all over the place. I mean, literally all over the place. And many of them still have not been excavated. I mean, they're excavating them all around the country, and every year, you know, new things are discovered and such. So Tom pulls out all the loot from the burial mound because he wants to expose it to the elements so it will be destroyed through time. But he gives the hobbits each something. He gives them each a sword. It's actually a dagger, but because they're midgets, a sword. Okay? Why? What is the source or origin of the swords? Who made these swords? We're told by Tom that the swords were forged for the ancient battle against the Witch King of Angmar, who is the captain of the Ringwraiths, the leader or the lord of the Nazgul. Okay? So now they have swords that were forged with spells woven in them to help defeat this guy. Then Tom walks them to the great east-west road. They can see Bree in the distance, and he's making sure they're going to get there safely. They arrive at Bree. They go to the sign of the Prancing Pony, a pub, an inn, and they get comfortable. They get unpacked. They decide to go and spend the evening in the common room where people are drinking. Okay. Take my course or take somebody else's course. Go to England. Go to London or go to a town outside London and go to a real English pub. Don't go to any of these crappy American versions of an English pub or an Irish pub. I like opossums, but it's a piss-poor imitation of a real pub. Okay? And go to a pub that doesn't have, we don't have one in here, idiotic TVs everywhere, or music blaring. Go to a pub where the only sound you hear is the sound of clinking glasses and conversation. I've got one in mind. It's my favorite pub in all of England. It's called Swiss Cottage. And it's going to be far away from where we're staying at the new place. But it's a pub. It's got knotty pine paneling all over. It's kind of dark. And the people that frequent it are old regulars. I mean, guys in their 60s, 70s, and 80s. That it is just fun to listen to. If you can understand them. Because their accents tend to get really thick. Right? Because what we see here, you sometimes will see at some of these English pubs. Where somebody will break into song. And then the people in the pub will start singing the song along with them. Depending upon the time of night and the amount of beer that's been poured. Okay? So, Frodo sits next to, unbeknownst to him, Strider. And Strider warns him about Pippin. Pippin's like 20 years old. Okay? Now, not 20 years old like some of you are 20 years old. 20 years old is more like 14 or 15. He's an idiot. Okay? He's really flighty. He doesn't think about things. And he's getting ready to spill the beans. So Frodo goes and kicks him off the table, and Frodo steps up to the table and starts to sing and dance. And he's got his fingers in his pockets, and his finger slips on the ring. Or the ring slips on his finger. He disappears. He crawls back under the tables to where he was sitting. And Strider says, page 161, "Now you put your foot in it, or should I say your finger, Mr. Baggins?" They go back to their room. Strider says he would like to help them. Barnum and Butterbur, the innkeeper, warns against that. And then remembers, "Oh, by the way, here's a letter for you, Mr. Baggins, that was delivered to Barnum and Wynn." Hey, what time of year is it now? At this point in the novel. They leave on Frodo's birthday, September 22nd. Okay? It's October already. Okay? It's October. When was the letter delivered to Barnum by Gandalf? Midsummer. Midsummer's Eve, I believe it was. So, 3.5 months ago, and Barnum never made sure that the letter was delivered to Frodo? So, he reads the letter, and the letter makes reference to Strider, but Gandalf says, make sure it's the real Strider, and he includes the verses. And Frodo's kind of like, you know, okay, okay, I trust you. But Sam's not quite there, page 171. "How do we know you're the Strider that Gandalf speaks about? You never mentioned Gandalf till this letter came out. You might be a play-acting spy, for all I can see, trying to get us to go with you. You might have done in the real Strider and took his clothes. What have you to say to that?" And Strider says that you're a stout fellow, Sam, but if I was a play-acting spy and killed the real Strider, you're dead too. And he stands up and he suddenly looks, you know, like he's 12 feet tall. But he says, "I am the real Strider. And if by life or death I can save you, I will." And Frodo's like, okay, that's good. You know, because I think one of his spies, meaning Sauron's spies, would seem, well, I don't know, fairer and feel fouler, if you understand. Okay, put yourself in Strider's shoes. What does Frodo just say? You look foul, but you feel fair. Now, there's a quality about you that I trust, but your looks don't help you. Viggo Mortensen, Strider in the films. What's the problem with the casting? You're smirking. He's too dadgum handsome.
Doesn't look like a thug.
Yeah. Well, it's not necessarily a thug. He doesn't look like a homeless person. I mean, you could smear as much mud and crap all over Viggo, and it's still Viggo Mortensen. It's just nice-looking crap and mud. Okay? I should pull this up on the computer. Do a Google search. Some of you may know who this guy is. Ever since I've read The Lord of the Rings and first saw a movie with him, Sam Elliott. Sam Elliott is the living embodiment of Strider. One, he's tall. Viggo Mortensen, if I remember right, Viggo Mortensen isn't real tall. Sam Elliott's like 6'5", 6'6". So he's tall. He's lanky. Okay? And he has the greatest male voice in the world. It's like gravel rolling, yeah. It's like gravel rolling down a hill. Okay? He's attractive, but he's not gorgeous. And when he lets his stubble grow, perfect. See, because one thing about Aragorn, Strider here, and you gotta pull up, I mean, Michelangelo just pulled up an image of Strider. Yeah, that was a lot better. Of Sam Elliott. You know, there's a lot of pictures of him. Find one of the ones where he's got some stubble and his hair is long. Whether it's a young picture of him or old, he's perfect for Strider. Okay? So Aragorn says, "I get it. I look foul and feel fair." Frodo's kind of like, "Sorry, didn't mean to." No, no, that's okay. So they find out what happened to Merry. He was overcome by one of the black riders in the dark. So they know there are black riders in town. And Aragorn says, "I will lead you." So they make their way to Weathertop, little mountain. And they find out Gandalf was there. It's now October 6th. Okay. They find runes carved in a rock that says G3, which Aragorn interprets to mean G, the rune for G, Gandalf, 3, meaning October the 3rd. That's when Gandalf was there. It's now October 6th. Just before they go up to the top, Sam sings a little song about Gil-galad, and they get there and they realize there are dark riders in the area, and Mary, I think it is, asks for more about Gil-galad. And Aragorn says, okay, I'll sing you something related, but I'm not going to talk about the ring and stuff because of the danger. So he tells them the story of Lúthien Tenúvial, which has a bearing on Aragorn's life. Okay. But he also says, Frodo, and this has a bearing also on you. And that's when they realize the Dark Rider, the Dark Black Riders are coming. And Frodo gives in to the temptation and puts on the ring. And when he puts on the ring, he suddenly sees the Black Riders clearly. But the others, Aragorn, Frodo, Sam, Merry, and Pippin, it's like he sees them through a mist or through a fog. Frodo is stabbed. The Black Riders are repelled. And they make their way to the Ford of Bruinen. They meet up with Arwen Evenstar. No. They meet up with Glorfindel. Why does Peter Jackson change Glorfindel into Arwen Evenstar? Why the sex change?
Love story.
Love story, yeah. I mean, he does bring that out. It's not in the book. I mean, there is the love story of Arwen and Aragorn, but it's not played out much in the book. So why bring in Liv Tyler at this point? In an interview, Peter Jackson said he did it for demographic reasons. He knew that many of his audience would be women, and therefore he needed more women roles in the film. The problem is, it changes the meaning, okay? Because Arwen is a relatively young elf. Arwen never experienced life, I don't think so, over here in Valinor. Glorfindel did. Glorfindel is one of the oldest elves alive. Okay? We're going to see later on, after Frodo gets past the Ford of Bruin and he wakes up in Rivendell, he's going to be talking to Gandalf, and Gandalf's going to say, you saw Glorfindel as he exists on the other side. He says, those who have lived in the Blessed Realm live in both places simultaneously. Like wherever Glorfindel is, he is both here and in the Blessed Realm. It's like he brings the Blessed Realm with him wherever he is. And the way Tolkien describes it, it's almost like this is a spiritual state, a spiritual frame of mind, as it were. Okay? So, Glorfindel puts Frodo on his horse, slaps the horse's rear, the horse goes on. The horse is now being pursued by the Nine Riders. Frodo gets to the river, he gets across the river and turns and faces the Black Riders as they're starting to come across the water. He stands up in his stirrups and he tells them, page 214, go back. Go back to the land of Mordor and follow me no more. The riders halt and then they laugh and they say, come back. Come back. To Mordor we will take you. Frodo, go back. The ring. The ring. Notice, they're calling to the ring as much as the ring is calling to them. By Elbereth and Lúthien the Fair. Elbereth is the queen of the gods. She's Manwë's wife. Okay? If you wanted to find a Catholic source, she'd be like Mary. She would rank like Mary in Catholicism. In Lúthien the Fair, you shall have neither the ring nor me. The captain of the Nine, the Witch King of Angmar, who's in the lead, raises his hand and Frodo's sword shatters. His tongue sticks to the roof of his mouth, and he plops off the horse. But before he plops off the horse, he sees these little flames of light coming behind the dark riders, and he sees the water rise up like giant horses. And he passes out. And we get to book two. Okay. He wakes up in the house of Elrond. Gandalf explains to him what I just said. Sam has been sitting beside him the whole time. He meets in that chapter many meetings. He sees Strider again, but he doesn't look like Strider now. Why? Because he's had a shave, he's gotten cleaned up. And he meets Elrond, who doesn't look like Agent Smith, no matter what you say about him. David Bowie actually wanted to play Elrond. And Peter Jackson wouldn't take him up on it. David Bowie would have been a fantastic Elrond. Might have been kind of weird, but I can't watch that and not see The Matrix. I mean, Elrond's about to go into some wild jujitsu, you know. He meets Bilbo, okay, who's getting pretty old at this point. And we get the chapter, The Council of Elrond. And we find out who's at the Council of Elrond. There's Frodo and Bilbo and Aragorn and Gandalf and Elrond, obviously, and Glorfindel and Glowin and his son Gimli. Glowin, one of the original dwarves from The Hobbit. And Legolas is there to represent the Northern Elves, and because he's got some bad news to bring. And Boromir and several other elves. Okay. So, Glowin speaks first about these messengers that have been coming to the land of the dwarves from Sauron. And so he speaks, and he finishes, and page 242, Elrond says, "You've done well to come. You'll hear today all that you need in order to understand the purposes of the enemy. There is naught you can do other than to resist, with hope or without it, but you do not stand alone. You will learn that your trouble is but part of the trouble of all the Western world. The ring. What shall we do with the ring? The least of rings, the trifle that Sauron fancies. That is the doom that we must deem. That is the judgment," that's what doom means there, "that we must judge." Okay? "That is the purpose for which you are called hither. Called, I say, though I have not called you to me. Strangers from distant lands, you have come and are here met in this very nick of time. By chance, as it may seem." Elrond's going to use that kind of language three or four times. "That this all seems to be chance, or by good fortune that you have come." Why does he use that kind of language? I don't think Elrond thinks there's any chance at all involved. There is another power at work beyond the design of the Ringmaker. Okay? "Yet it is not so. That is, it is not chance. Believe rather that it is so ordered." That's Boethius. That is entirely from the Consolation of Philosophy. That is, this other power's ordering of the world, "that we who sit here and none others must now find counsel for the peril of the world." So they listen while Elrond speaks. And Elrond talks about Sauron, the rings of power, they're forging in the second age of the world. Some of his tale was known to some there, but the full tale was known to none. He talks about the elven smiths. He talks about the great battle in Mordor. And he says, page 243, "I remember the splendor of their banners. Recall to me the glory of the elder days, the hosts of Beleriand, blah, blah, blah." Frodo's like, "Excuse me, you remember? I thought that the fall of Gil-galad was a long age ago." "So it was, but my memory reaches back even to the elder days. Irindil was my sire, who was born in Gondolin. Over here in the land of Beleriand before the world was changed." Okay. Irindil was my sire, who was born in Gondolin before its fall, and my mother was Elwing, daughter of Dior, son of Luthien of Doriath. So let's go back for a second. We had the tale of Beren and Luthien. Okay? What did Elrond just say? Go back. My sire was Irindil. My mother was Elwing, daughter of Dior, son of Luthien. Dior, Elwing, married Irindil. Okay? Irindil is an elf. Elwing is part elf, okay, because of her mother, Luthien, part man, because of Beren. Luthien's parents, draw a blank on her father's name, and her mother's name. Mom was a Maia. Okay? Father, really, just complete blank on both their names. So, he says, I have seen three ages in the west of the world, many defeats. I was the herald of Gil-galad, marched with his host. I was at the battle. I saw Sauron's ringer, finger cut off. I tried to tell Isildur, take the ring and go destroy it, but he wouldn't. Okay. Boromir says, we've never heard this story. Notice he just jumps up and interrupts. Okay. Elrond explains, the ring is called Isildur's Bane. Why? Because it was the bane, the death, that's what bane means, of Isildur. It's not an accident that the big, you know, hulky Tom Hardy character in Batman is named Bane, because it means death. Okay? So he finishes his speech, and then Boromir finally steps up and says, let me talk now. Okay? Because Elrond's kind of said, you know, the weakness of men, Sauron's gotten stronger. So he stands up to essentially defend the honor of Gondor. And he says, you guys can kind of sit fat, dumb, and happy up here because we stand at arms in the south against Mordor. Turn for a moment, if you have it. That's too big. That's too big. To this map, okay? Mordor's down here, okay? Minas Tirith is right around here. Rivendell's up here, okay? And what Boromir is saying is, we kind of stand as the shield wall, protecting everybody north of Mordor. Okay? So he tells his bit, and he says, you know, this vision came to my brother, and then it came to me, and he tells them the voice, or the poem of the vision. He says, we didn't understand it. All we knew was that Imladris is way up in the north. So he says, I came. And Elrond says, and everything, excuse me, Aragorn says, and here in the house of Elrond, more shall be made clear to you. He stands up, pulls his sword out of his scabbard, and throws it on the table. But the sword's useless because it's broken. It's in pieces. But Boromir just recited a poem that mentioned the sword that was broken. And Aragorn says, this is the sword that was broken. This is the sword that belonged to Isildur. This is the sword that cut Sauron's finger off. Boromir, who are you? Elrond. Notice the difference in the film. In the film, Elrond doesn't like Aragorn. You could tell there's a lot of animosity there. Simply because Aragorn wants to marry his daughter. Okay? He is Aragorn, son of Arathorn, and he has descended through many fathers, from Isildur, Elendil's son of Minas Ithil. He is the chief of the Dúnedain in the north, and few are now left of that folk. Okay, so that's a lot of big words there. What does that mean? He is the future king of Gondor. Boromir would understand that genealogy. If he is a direct descendant of Isildur, he should be sitting on the throne. Not Boromir's daddy, Denethor, who is ruling as steward. Frodo, then it's yours. The ring is yours. Okay? So Gandalf tells Frodo, Frodo, bring out the ring. Show them all Isildur's banner. Boromir's eyes glinted. See, when somebody's eyes glint, it means one of two things in the Lord of the Rings. Either they're really angry, or they've suddenly got a spirit of desire, avarice, covetousness over something they're seeing. They want something badly. Boromir's eyes glinted. And he says, the halfling, he was in the poem too. Then the doom of Minas Tirith come at last? And Aragorn corrects Boromir's interpretation of the poem. The poem didn't say the doom of Minas Tirith. It just said, then doom is near at hand. Doom just means judgment. The poem didn't say judgment for whom. So Aragorn says, the words were not the doom of Minas Tirith, but this, the sword that was broken is the sword of Elendil that broke beneath him when he fell. It's been treasured by his heirs. And so he says, Isildur's bane has been found. What do you seek? What do you want, Boromir? Do you want the house of Elendil to return to Gondor? In other words, are you and your father willing to step aside and let the king return? How long has there not been a king in Gondor? It's been over 3,000 years.
2 pages of men.
Yeah. What is that equivalent to? We have a people on earth now that had a king 3,000 years ago that would probably like a king like this person to return. I'm thinking of David. David existed around 1,000 BC, roughly 3,000 years ago. I bet the Jews would like a leader of David's caliber today. Whip the Palestinians into shape in no time. Okay? What else would this be equivalent to? In a non-historical or quasi-historical sense.
Arthur.
The return of the king. In true Arthurian myth, Arthur is not dead. Arthur is merely resting. He is merely waiting for the time when England, or Logres by its real name, has its greatest need. And when its greatest need comes, Arthur will return, according to that myth. So the sword that was broken?
Excalibur?
Yeah, Excalibur. Okay. Imagine for a moment. What would happen? Some pointy head archaeologist is digging off in Wales. He's digging some old site. And he pulls up an old rusty scabbard. And pulls a sword out of it. And the sword is made of gold. Because it won't rot. It won't rust. And the gold has inscribed in runes. Arthur had me made. I am called Excalibur. And this thing dates from 430 AD, which would be right about the perfect time for Arthur to have lived. What would that do to English history? It would turn it on its head. Because this would be read as, okay. And not only Arthur had been made, but Arthur Rex, King Arthur, had me made. It would be incontrovertible proof that there was a King Arthur. Okay, he might not have been king of all the Britons, but there was a guy named Arthur who was king, and he had a sword named Excalibur. That kind of does what to all the myth?
Validates them?
Yeah. It's like what the Shire would be for Frodo while he's wandering around. It anchors it all to something. Okay? So Aragorn stands up and says, here's the sword that was broken. Here's Excalibur. Do you want Arthur to return? After 3,000 years? I was not sent to beg any boon, but only to seek the meaning of a riddle. What's Boromir saying there? What, and Daddy lose his job? I'm not here to seek any reward from anybody. Okay? And then Bilbo stands up. Aragorn, kind of, shut up, Bilbo, sit down. What does Aragorn say to Boromir? I forgive your doubt. Why? Little do I resemble the figures of Elendil and Isildur as they stand carven in their majesty in the halls of Denethor. Okay, what does that mean? What does Aragorn know about the halls of Denethor? He's been there. He has seen them. He says, I don't look like them. I am but the heir of Isildur, not Isildur himself. I've had a hard life and a long. The leagues that lie between here and Gondor are a small part in the count of my journey. Because Boromir said, I traveled a long way to get here. Aragorn's like, child's play. And he gives an example of how far he has gone. Go back to one of those maps. He's gone off the map to the east. Literally. He's gone off the map to the south. So the land, the travel between Gondor and here, it's nothing, Boromir. Come on. Put on your big boy pants. Let's go for a real hike. He says, but my home, such as I have it, it's in the north. And he says, if Gondor Boromir has been a stalwart tower, we Rangers of the North, we played another part. And he gives us this beautiful example. You know little of the lands beyond your bounds. Peace and freedom? Sounds like an American election campaign. Peace and freedom? The North would have known them little but for us. Fear would have destroyed them, that is, the people in the North. But when dark things come from the houseless hills or creep from sunless woods, they fly from us. What roads would any dare to tread? What safety would there be in quiet lands or in the homes of simple men at night if the Dunedain were asleep or were all gone into the grave? What's he saying about himself and his compatriots? They're sentinels in the dark. And yet less thanks have we than you. Travelers scowl at us, and countrymen give us scornful names. Strider I am to one fat man, Barlaman Butterbur, who lives within a day's march of foes that would freeze his heart. What kind of foes does he mean? Ordinary men? No. Or lay his little town in ruin if he were not guarded ceaselessly. Yet we would not have it otherwise. That is, we Rangers of the North would not have these people know that they are guarded by us. If simple folk are free from care and fear, simple they will be. That is, then they should remain simple. Why are they simple? Because they are free from care and fear. It is cares and fears that do what? Make you complex. That make you understand how the world works. That is why children are meant to be innocent. They're not meant to have fears and cares. That's why they're supposed to be protected by parents. And parents that abuse them deserve bad things to happen to them. Because they're denying those children what they ought to have as a birthright. If simple folk are free from care and fear, simple they will be, and we must be secret to keep them so. He says, it's our job to keep them simple and free from care and free. That has been the task of my kindred while the years have lengthened and the grass has grown. Okay? He's saying, Boromir, people know what you do. People don't know what we do. You know, it's a wonderful thing now when you see a soldier get on a flight. You know, you're at the airport and the flight attendant or the person at the gate will say, and we'd like to allow or ask all of our, you know, active duty military to get on board first. I had this experience when I flew out to Oregon for my mom's death. And the people waiting at the gate, you know, give them a hand. Give them a round of applause. 40 years ago, that didn't happen. 20 years ago, that didn't happen. But in the 70s, almost the exact opposite happened, where soldiers came back from Vietnam and were spat upon. Okay? And yet they were, in their own way, doing exactly what Aragorn is talking about. But now the world is changing again. A new hour comes. Isildur's bane is found. Battle is at hand. So the sword shall be reforged. I will come to Minas Tirith. Notice, there's no request there. There's no, you know, if it's okay with you. Aragorn is saying, the king's coming back. Now, he won't be king just by going there. Certain things have got to be done before he can become king of Minas Tirith. Okay? Boromir, I've seen a ring. How do I know that's Isildur's bane? Elrond, that shall be told. Bilbo says, not yet. I'm hungry. So Bilbo tells his tale. Okay. And then Gandalf speaks. And Gandalf tells about his researches into the ring lore. And he says about what he did with Frodo's ring. He threw it into the fire. And he speaks those words of Mordor tongue. Ashnaz Durbatulak, Ashnaz Gimbatul, Ashnaz Thrakatulak, Agburzim Ishi Krimpatul. On page 254. The change in the wizard's voice was astounding. Suddenly it became menacing, powerful, harsh as stone. Shadows seemed to pass over the high sun, and the porch for a moment grew dark. All trembled, and the elves go, ah! You know, he spoke a dirty language. And Elrond says, nobody's ever spoken that language in Imladris, Gandalf. And Gandalf says, and let's hope it's not spoken again. It has a lot of hard, what are called velar sounds, sounds made in the back of the throat, and a lot of fricatives, rubbing sounds. It's not full of sibilance, okay? Sounds or liquids, like the Elvish languages are. The Elvish languages are like music. This is like jangling chains. It's very Germanic in that sense. Gandalf saying, and if we don't want the Nazis to run into Rivendell, we better be about our business, okay? So he talks a little bit about Gollum. And then Legolas says, got some bad news for you. Gollum has escaped. Okay? Gandalf goes on. He talks about his meeting with Saruman. Now, Saruman tricked Gandalf into coming. And they have an interview, page 259. And Saruman says, and now that you've come here, Gandalf, you're going to rest from your journeys and from your labors. For I am Saruman the Wise, Saruman Ringmaker, Saruman of many colors. And Gandalf says, you know, and I looked and I noticed, you know, his robe wasn't white. It was many colors. It shimmered when he moved, like Saruman in the Amazing Technicolor coat. And he says, I liked white better. Saruman, white. It serves as a beginning. Think about that for a minute. Saruman is a physicist. Because what is white? Think of colors. You get the various colors from white. What do you have to do? You have to analyze it. You have to break it down. Okay? White. It serves as a beginning. The white cloth may be dyed, the white page can be overwritten, and the white light can be broken. And then one of my favorite quotes from Gandalf. In which case it is no longer white. And he that breaks a thing to find out what it is has left the path of wisdom. If you have to destroy something to discover what it is, you've left the path of wisdom. Because what are you left with?
Pieces.
Read that Tolkien essay that I uploaded to the D2L site. Because this is an example of something that he talks about in that essay. He mentions the cauldron of story. Story is like a stew. You know, everybody in here has had a stew before. Even if you're vegan, before you became a vegan, you had a stew at some point in your life. How do you make a stew?
You throw everything in a pot.
You throw everything into a pot. You get water, you get meat, you get potatoes, you get carrots, you might put cabbage, you might put, you know, onion, you put a bunch of spices, and you do what? You turn on the heat. And you cook it. And you cook it, and you cook it, and you cook it, and you cook it. And it tastes good. But if you take all of those ingredients, and I invite you all over to my house and say, we're going to have a stew, and I have a pot of water, and I have a slab of meat, and a bunch of raw potatoes, and a bunch of raw carrots, and a bunch of raw onions, and a bunch of spices, and a pile of pepper, and say, dig in. And you start with a spoon, and you get a little bit of water, and you get a little bit of meat, and you get a little bit of carrot, and you eat that, what do you do? Because that's not stew. It's raw ingredients, right? Okay. Tolkien says, those who take a story apart to try to understand the story have left the path of wisdom. And he writes that because he really hated what people did with the old English poem, Beowulf. They read Beowulf not as a poem. They read Beowulf as a source of information about Germanic customs in the 6th and 7th century. What does this teach us about gift-giving customs? What does this teach us about the role of women? What does this teach us about the importance of swords? What does this teach us about heroism? Not, what does the poem mean? How does the poem work? What does the poem tell us? Okay? He that breaks a thing to find out what it is has left the path of wisdom. Saruman doesn't like being taught lessons. So they start to talk some more. Why does Saruman have Gandalf there? What does he want from Gandalf?
Help.
What else?
Companionship.
Okay, that can be carried a little too far. You can get into slash fiction and go places I don't want you to go to. What is he?
Information.
He wants them to join. Join their powers.
You said companionship. Let's go in slash fiction.
Well, yeah. Sorry, not joining that way. Okay? He says we can unite our powers and we can do what? We can join with Sauron and maybe after time do what? Well, yeah, but he also says we can turn him into the direction we want him to go. Okay? Yeah, there's going to be some excesses. There are going to be some bad things done. We know that. But, you know, we do need, after all, what does he say? We need, bottom of 259, we can approve the ultimate and high purpose, knowledge. Rule. Order. Gandalf's like, Saruman, come on. What is this we you're talking about? This isn't, you know, like a bicycle built for two. It doesn't have two seats. This isn't a ring with two holes. One for your finger and one for my finger. Like we're going to go walking down the street, you know, hand in hand. Uh-uh. Only one ring, only one hand can wield the ring at a time. Okay? And Gandalf says, I've heard this kind of speech before, but it's come from Sauron. Kind of interesting because what Tolkien is talking about here, I always go off into these tangents, used to be a major foreign policy of the United States. MFN, most favored nation trading status, was always a huge congressional fight in the 80s and 90s because it always revolved around one nation that it was a big fight for. China. Or as Rush Limbaugh likes to call them, the Chi-Coms. Okay? Why? Because we always had one part of the American political process who wanted to expand trade with China after Nixon opened China up to trade and such. And we had the other part said, no, we shouldn't have anything to do with China because they're horrible with human rights. They kill their people, they imprison Christians, blah, 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 blah. And the one group that wanted to open up China to more rule would always say, yeah, but if we break off all relation with China, if we don't do any trade with them, then they'll just get more entrenched in their position. But if we work with them, if we grant them most favored nation trading status, then we can gradually bend them to our way of life. We can get them to liberalize. We've been doing this for 30 freaking years. How liberalized has China become? They still, every year, you read accounts of the government paving Christians into roads as a means of kind of putting them into their place. I mean, literally, putting Christians down in asphalt and running steamrollers over them, right into the roads, and then lay another layer of asphalt right down on top of them and build a road. If you need the proof, I can show you the articles. That's this idea of, okay, you've got this horrific government, but, you know, if we work with them, we can gradually turn them to our way. Gandalf says, hell no. What's this getting at? What was the phrase I had up here earlier? Ends justifying the means. The means are, okay, so we have to get into bed with Sauron, and that's kind of nasty. But the ends, knowledge, rule, order, everybody wants that. So Gandalf says no, and he gets imprisoned by Sauron. Saruman, until Gwaihir the Windlord comes and rescues him. Notice what doesn't happen that happens in that god-awful film. What do Saruman and Gandalf not do here? There's no Count Dooku Yoda, you know, battle, which is essentially what it is. I mean, that Star Wars film and this Lord of the Rings film came out at the same time, and it's essentially the same thing. Wizard jujitsu, they don't do it. Okay. Similarly, we're going to see when Gandalf and the others get to Medisild, and we meet Theoden. Theoden isn't being possessed. This is not demonic possession by Saruman. Gandalf doesn't have to point his staff at him and say, I charge thee, come out of him, Saruman. It's ridiculous. That is utterly asinine. That is a 10-year-old's level of understanding. Okay? So, Gandalf explains, I got freed. I galloped to a weather top, etc., etc. So they come down finally to, what do we do with the ring? Page 265. And Elrond speaks again. He says, you know, I forgot about Tom Bombadil. Earwin Ben-Adar. I don't know what the name Yarwin men means, but Ben Adar? It's actually Hebrew. It means son of earth. Is Tom Bombadil like an embodiment of the earth spirit? Is it not Gaia, but, you know, Tom Bombadilla or something? Gandalf, he wouldn't have come. Well, you know, we could have tried. Gandalf, no. He doesn't have a power over the ring. It's that the ring has no power over him. He's his own master. He cannot alter the ring itself. Remember what Tom Bombadil does with the ring? He asks Frodo for it. Frodo hands it to him. Notice, Frodo, he doesn't even have any qualms. He just takes it off and hands it to him. And Tom Bombadil kind of hands it to him, and he just does this, flips it up in the air, and it disappears. And Frodo's like, ah! He's calm down. And then he puts it on, and he doesn't disappear. He gives it back to Frodo. Frodo puts it on, disappears, tries to go out, and Tom Bombadil's, yo, Frodo, come back. I don't think that's going to stop me from seeing you. Okay. So, can't give it to Tom Bombadil. So what else do they discuss? Okay, so page 266. Glorfindel. We could send it over the sea or destroy it. That is, we could try to send it to Valinor, to the gods, or we could try to destroy it. Elrond. We can't destroy it by any craft we possess. They who dwell beyond the sea, they wouldn't take it. It's our problem. It's our problem. What is Gandalf slash Tolkien saying about our problems? We have to deal with them. We shouldn't pass them on. Like government has been doing for years for a variety of problems. Like Social Security. Okay. Glorfindel. Okay. Can't do those. Let's throw it into the ocean. Throw it down into the, you know, Laurentian Abyss or into the Marianas Trench off the coast of the Philippines. So 28,000 feet deep. Nobody will get it. Gandalf, not so safe. You know, time rolls on, and what happens? The ocean kicks up stuff. Okay, so it won't be safe forever. Notice what Gandalf's saying. We need to deal with the ring forever. Okay, what else? Elrond. We must take a hard road, top of 267. A road unforeseen. There lies our hope, if hope it be, to walk into peril to Mordor. We must send the ring to the fire. Boromir, pause, time out. Why? Why can't we use it? And Elrond explains why. Its strength, Boromir, is too great for anyone to wield at will, save only those who have already great power of their own. But even for them, it holds an even deadlier peril. The very desire of it corrupts the heart. Saruman's your example. For nothing is evil in the beginning. Even Sauron was not so. I fear to take the ring to hide it. I will not take the ring to wield it. Nor I, says Gandalf. But Boromir's like, I will. Just give it to me. Okay. So, they come down again. It needs to be destroyed. And there's silence. And everybody is, if you've ever been in a meeting like this, where a big decision has been made that somebody has to do something, what does everybody in the meeting do? They don't look up. Because as soon as you look somebody else in the eye, you're it. So everybody pretends to be busy, and Frodo says, I will take the ring, though I do not know the way. Listen to Elrond's words. If I understand aright all that I have heard, this is page 270, I think that this task is appointed for you, Frodo, and that if you do not find a way, no one will. This is the hour of the Shire folk when they arise from their quiet fields to shake the towers and councils of the great. It is not that trite idiocy that Peter Jackson puts in Elrond's mouth. Ooh, it's a time for the little people to do great things, to shake the world. No. What does Elrond mean there? The hour of the Shire folk when they arise from their quiet fields to shake the towers and councils of the great. Okay, the Shire Folk are the Shire Folk, the hobbits. But what else does Tolkien mean by them? What do we hear people running for president say about the electorate, those people who will elect them? Okay, keep going. What do we not have in Washington?
Representation.
A voice. What do we, I mean, we hear this from both sides. The Democrats say the Republicans represent the powerful, the rich. The Republicans say the Democrats represent the powerful, the rich. And then individually they say, but I will go to Washington and I will speak for you. I will speak for the common man. I won't speak for Wall Street, I'll speak for Main Street. Okay? What Tolkien is saying is this is the time for the common man, the every man, the ordinary person going about his daily job. And what does he mean by that? Can, to use the trite phrase, little people do great things? You betcha. You betcha. We see it all the time in the news. We don't see it enough because the news focuses on bad things happening. It doesn't show as much good things happening. You know, the train incident in France last fall, where you had three Americans on a train. They see a guy. He pulls out an automatic weapon. And what do? Without even thinking, they jump him. Because they kind of immediately put together packed train, crazy person with automatic weapon. Not a good scenario. Okay? There was a similar incident in Washington, D.C. on a subway. The only difference there, nobody tried to take the guy out. The guy didn't have an AK-47. He had a knife. But there we actually have accounts of people who saw him and intentionally did nothing. Everyday, ordinary people. Think, what was it, Flight 93? Todd Beamer and the other guys on the flight who took the plane down so it didn't hit the Capitol? Not one of those guys, as far as we know, or as far as I know, not one of those guys was, you know, former Special Forces or anything. These are everyday, ordinary people doing what? Doing as Gandalf tells Frodo, what they have time to do. Making a decision to do what they could with the time they had. Frodo steps up to the plate. Does he know how he's going to do this? Does he have everything planned out?
Nope.
Does he have a map?
Nope.
He doesn't even have a freaking map. Okay.
He doesn't know the way.
And he doesn't know the way. But he's going to try, okay? So, they come up with the Fellowship of the Ring. Who's included? Well, Frodo.
Sam.
He's the ring bearer. Sam, why? Try to pry him off or away from Frodo. He's like Charlton Heston with a rifle from my cold dead fingers. Who else? Leave the other two hobbits aside for a moment.
Aragorn.
Okay, we'll go with him.
Legolas.
Aragorn. Why? Aragorn.
He needs to.
Because this is a big test, man. Okay. Legolas, we said. Why Legolas?
Represent
the elves. And maybe a little, because you guys lost Gollum. This is a little slight punishment. Who else?
Gimli.
Gimli. Why? Represents the dwarves. Okay. Who else? Boromir. Why?
Because he came along with Aragorn. I can't remember why though.
Well, he didn't come with Aragorn. Where's his home? Next door to Mordor. So he's got to head south anyways. He may as well tag along for the ride and to help represent men. Okay, this is a battle that concerns him. Who else?
Gandalf.
Yeah, Gandalf, big one. Why? Because what does Elrond say? This will be Gandalf's greatest task. Okay. So that's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, but we need 9 to counter the 9 riders. 9 walkers to match the 9 black riders. Who does Elrond want to send? Yeah, an elf lord, a warrior. Somebody with a big sword, you know.
He wants to send the other hobbits back as messengers.
He wants to send Merry Pippin back to the Shire to do what? Warn them, to prepare them. What are we being told? The Shire's not safe. If Merry Pippin had gone back, would the Shire be saved, prepared?
Maybe.
It might have been, but what wouldn't have happened? If you've read The Lord of the Rings, 2 really huge, major things wouldn't have happened. Okay? So, Merry and Pippin go. Why? What reason or logic does Gandalf use? Trust rather to friendship than to strength. Okay? And they go south. And we're going to skip a whole bunch. We get the journey in the dark. They arrive to Moria. They try to go over Mount Caradhras. And the mountain doesn't let them. The snowstorm and everything. So they go another way. They arrive at the doors of Moria, Durin's doors. Gandalf figures out the clue. They go inside. They make their way in. Gimli is, you know, so happy to be in his homeland. And they come to a big guard room, like this room. And in that guard room, there is an open well. Not what you see in the film. Pippin doesn't go up and knock a skeleton in. Pippin, everybody else kind of beds down for night. Pippin goes up to the well. And I'm sorry, but if I were in there, I'd have done the same thing. Who wouldn't go to a really big, deep hole in the ground and go, wonder how deep this is? And he drops a rock in. What does Gandalf do? Fool of a took. Next time, throw yourself in and be done with you. This is not a hobbit walking party. Okay? And so he gives Pippin the first night's watch. And Pippin's scared. And Gandalf can't sleep. So Gandalf goes up to him and he says, it's okay. Go lay down. I'll take over your watch. And what happens? They hear a hammer. Gandalf's like, oh, great. You woke something up. What did Pippin wake up?
Balrog.
More specifically, the orcs. The Balrog doesn't beat the hammer. But when the orcs wake up, the Balrog also is awakened. So they get attacked by orcs. They flee. I'm skipping more than I want to. And when they flee, Gandalf senses a presence. He puts his locking spell on the door. There's a counter spell. Gandalf, he says, speaks a word of command. And the door shatters. And he makes his way back down to the rest of them, down by the bridge of Casa Doom. And he says, I'm spent. That is, I need to plug in. I've lost all my power. I've met a foe I have not met in a long time. Okay? They make their way across. And we see the orcs all fleeing like ants from fire. And this big winged shadow thing. And Gandalf's like, great, Balrog. And here I am, tired. He tells the others to flee. And he stands out there on the middle of the bridge and says, you shall not pass. I am a wielder of the secret fire. A servant of the secret fire. A wielder of the flame of Anor. He's talking about Glamdring, the sword that he wields. But a servant of the secret fire? That's this. He is a servant of Eru Iluvatar. He's saying, you're not going to touch my friends. Okay? And he falls when the Balrog gets his whip around his feet. Okay? So Gandalf dies. And the others go on. We'll pick up next week with Lothlorien. But what's the point I want to make here? Why are the orcs awakened? Because of the Pippin. Okay? But what happens as a result of Gandalf's fall?
He rises stronger.
He comes back as Gandalf the White. Would they have achieved the goals of the quest and everything with only Gandalf the Grey? No, they wouldn't have. They need Gandalf the White. He needs to become more powerful than Saruman. How does he do that? By dying and coming back. And he tells us where he went. He doesn't tell us what happened exactly when he went there. He just says, I walked along, you know, unknown paths and such, and I was sent back naked. And that can mean two things. It can mean naked without any clothes on, or it can mean naked without a body. He was sent back as a spirit and was then clothed by someone. Okay? We'll stop there. So, we'll try to pick up with the chapter Lothlorien. And I should be able to get through the rest of this chapter of this book pretty quickly, and then